The following broadcast is intended for mature audiences. These are real people sharing very real, deeply personal experiences. This content may be considered triggering for others and for those who are sharing. The chat room is a privilege intended for discussions and sharing. You are not being asked to agree, but you are being asked to stay civil and refrain from personal attacks. Listener discretion is advised.
Welcome back to Am I Mental, a live podcast where people share stories about how mental health impacts life and how life impacts mental health. I'm your host, E, and with us tonight is our co-host, Oz.
What's up, Am I Mental fan?
And I'm just going to have to say, happy birthday, Oz, and it sucks that you're here tonight because I know that you weren't planning on being here, but you're sick. So...
It's the world's birthday present to me. But, I mean, I'm here with fam, so I'm good.
And, yeah, so tonight I've been warning you guys that you've been paying attention to social media, the Discord. Tonight we are going to be giving a tearjerker of a story. I'm going to be talking to one of my longest-term friends, at times one of my closest friends. When I say longest-term friends, I have known this person since we dug in a sandbox in a daycare center before we even started kindergarten. We've known each other for a very, very long time. She holds a very near and dear place to my heart and always will. Tonight we have Carrie. Why don't you introduce yourself?
Hello. My name's Carrie. Nice to see my lifelong friend for the first time in 20 years.
Right? Yeah, I still remember your reaction when my dad posted that photo. Somebody posted a photo of my family all on that couch in my grandma's house back when I was like 12. And you're like, hey, I remember that face.
I know that kid. That's who I was expecting to see when I just saw you today. I'm like, oh,
yeah,
we're old, honey. We're old.
We are. We are definitely old. So before we get started, I do want to do a little housekeeping here. Give the show a like, give us a follow, give us a thumbs up. Whatever it is your platform that you're listening to us on does, do that. If you want to join us in the chat room, all you have to do is go to, you just go to amimental.net, hit the listen now button, and it'll take you to our host, sign up a free account, and join us in the chat. They do not spam you. They do not sell your information. That's why we use them. Outside of that, go ahead and share some episodes. If you know someone that's having a problem or an issue or a crisis or could just use a pick-me-up and there's an episode that you think they could relate to, share it with them. You never know how things could go. We have been credited with sharing multiple lives at this point. And, that's better than we could have ever hoped for. You know, just helping a life would have been enough for this podcast. But saving lives, plural, that is just amazing. And on top of that, if you want to help us further, you can help us financially by going to amimental.net/donate. There's a number of ways you can donate. There's subscriptions like through LibrePay. There's one-time payments through like Venmo. And there's also a merchandise store with a Teespring. And if there's anything that you'd like us to make and we don't have, just let us know. You can just email us at guest@amimental.net. Doesn't matter if it's plural or singular. We got them both covered. Outside of all that, Carrie, why don't you tell us a little bit about what we're talking about tonight?
Well, mental health. That's a wide topic, mental health.
We brought you on mainly for the story about your son.
My son.
Yes, because the episode is titled that about your son having a blood blister going horribly wrong. I will happily bring you back for other episodes, happily.
But right?
this is the topic. I think that it's still, you've had time to process. We've talked. You said that you feel ready to share. I think that this is something that
I'm really glad that I was unfortunately had to back out last weekend because that was a whole new experience. And I was like, ooh.
It's a good bookend to this whole thing.
Ooh, that I did not expect that. I was like, ooh, this was real. I got to tell Eric I can't do this. But
Name drop.
My son. Sorry. I told you, you can't watch my mouth. You have to tell me things. I don't trust myself. So my son is 16. He's the typical boy from birth, just wild and out. And from trampoline to trampoline, from countertop to table, whatever he can jump off of and swing from, he's all boy. All the time.
And you have him out in the middle of the wilderness, which just makes it even more so.
Oh, there's creatures that have come into my home that I don't think were ever supposed to be in a home. Like, boys are a different breed of child. Yes. he's been to the doctor one time for a sprained ankle that was so severely sprained. He ended up in a cast because that was a trampoline incident, but he was super pumped. He landed the trick. He did, but we broke an ankle, but whatever. Okay. And so, healthy, absolutely no underlying conditions, cold here and there, never, just super healthy. And there was a flu going around, and, some of his friends had had it, and it was a pretty severe flu. They'd had it 3-4 days, and vomiting, diarrhea, and fever. And so he got a 103 at one point fever, and we're like, oh man, you got this bug that's going around. And
103 is not dangerous, not per se, but it's one where you're definitely on high alert.
So you're edging on dangerous.
Yeah, that's at the point where you're doing, okay, we need medicine to bring this down, and we need cold compresses, we need cooler baths, we need something.
Yeah, we put him, because it was like 103.9 or something. It was like almost 104. Ooh. And I was like, ooh. And so the nearest hospital, which is just a critical care center, it's a Band-Aid station to get us to the nearest hospital, which would be 120 miles away. So, but the nearest hospital is 25 miles away, the critical care center. So I'm like, ooh, okay. Got him in the shower, got his temp down. And for the next 2 days, it stayed around 100, 101 at the highest, but
that's low enough to where you don't need to worry too much. I mean, you're still concerned, still monitoring, but not like, oh god.
Yeah, not like, ooh, this is real bad, and
not sitting there going, my baby. we are hung up again. So if you guys haven't figured it out, Carrie is out in the middle of the boonies, 120 miles away from a hospital, 25 miles from a critical care facility. Internet may not be the greatest, but here she comes. Nope, you're still hesitating.
Yeah. Happens to me sometimes as well. Out in Grass Valley, and I'm not really not that rural.
And I was like...
Oh.
Wait, no, here we did are. Not. Okay,
we lost you, Carrie.
We lost you. Like, you were
well,
just
I talking... Well, I am in the inland northwest in the middle of nowhere, so...
Yeah, I was just telling her, I was like, remember, she said 120 miles from a hospital, 25 from critical care. That's boonies. That is more boonies than what I was like, I grew up in the boonies, but you went even boonier boonies.
Oh, yeah.
When you're given landmarks for directions, you're talking about make a left at the crooked tree down the dirt road.
There might be a big metal fish hanging from a fishing pole as like on the highway by my house. Yeah, we're in the town is 1 mile long. 1 mile long. We have two restaurants and a grocery store and like 9 bars.
That sounds about right for being out in the middle of nowhere. Yeah. That's like our hometown had a grocery store, a small supermarket, a couple of delis, a couple of restaurants, and bars everywhere.
Yeah, our hometown is like a metropolis compared.
Oh, yeah. I mean, even...
My husband's lucky, I love him. That's all I got to say.
Even Dietz Road had its own bar for a while. And that's out in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, you'd be lucky to find me on a map. It's our town, including the cats and the dogs in the Outer Lane area, is 900 people.
Wow.
Ooh, wow.
Yeah, so I get a little... I just want Taco Bell once in a while. That's really it. That's all I need in life. And a few strangers to not know my business, and I'm good.
You should come visit me sometime. Bring the fam. I have plenty of room.
I am in. Like,
and we will.
That's all I need.
And we will go and we will eat. Oh, we have Adalberto's. We have Taco Bell. We have Del Taco. We have Jim Boy's Tacos. We got it all.
Nice. My husband asked me, he's like, what do you miss about being, in the city? I was like, strangers and fast food. That's what I missed. Strangers and fast food. That's it. Oh, my dog's whining. Sorry. Yeah, I get off course easy. Sorry.
Yeah, no worries.
Blonde, deep roots.
My hair's only gotten darkened over the years, but if I all I do is go out, sit out in the sun for like a couple hours, and I blonde right up again.
I don't sit out in the sun because I'm a marshmallow. And it's not okay. Put a marshmallow in the microwave. It takes about 3 seconds for that sucker to catch on fire, and that's about how long it takes me to burn. So, nope.
So you're basically a vampire.
Yeah.
All right, so your son's temperature was hovering. Yeah, he was hovering around 100, 101.
Oh, yeah.
Or almost 104.
Well, he got to almost 104, yeah.
So, you know, by the time we would have gotten him in the car to get him to the, you know, the critical care place, it's 25 miles. A shower is going to be a lot quicker to bring that temperature down. So, and I work in the town that has I work for the critical care unit, actually. The psychiatric place I work for is subcontracted through the hospital that's 25 miles away. So I was at work. And
see, you work at a psychiatric place, which means that's why I want a second episode with you, because I want to talk about that.
You got it. And I went there from a chemical dependency clinic. So I'm in. But so my husband, you know, got Darren in the shower and blah, 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 and got his temp down. And then his, you know, complained his back ached. And I was like, you're too dehydrated, bud. Those are kidneys. Ooh, anyone that's ever drank too hard the night before knows that pain. I'm like, okay, yep, we're dehydrated. And
my lower back hurts just in this area.
I'm like, ooh, those are kidneys. Huh, you're not drinking enough. And he hadn't had food that he kept down, you know, for 2 days. And just a severe flu. And it was Thanksgiving, or the night before Thanksgiving. It was about 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock at night. And he's like, oh, my back really hurts. Can I just go to, like, can they give me fluids at the hospital? And I was like, oh, that's a big deal right there. I was like, do you think you need to go? Because if he says he thinks he needs to go, that means we should have went days ago, because the kid doesn't complain about anything. And I was like, I'll go right now if you want to go. And I was talking to my husband, and he fell asleep.
You're like tugging your shoes on going, oh, you need to go?
Yep, here we go. Let's do it. And my son fell asleep. And I said, okay, well, it's the middle of the night. They're going to have to call a doctor in, blah, blah, blah. He's sleeping right now, but I'm taking him first thing in the morning. So Thanksgiving morning, we get up, and my son is just, his back hurts bad. And so we get him ready, and we get him over to the hospital. And you know, I'm wheeling him in there in the wheelchair, and I'm like, I'll Mario Kart race you. You know, like, he's not showing any signs of, I mean, just physically, but he's mentally all that, you know, everything's good. He just has a severe flu. They hook him up to some.
So you're keeping IVs. His spirits up.
Yeah. Oh, that's where I go. Humor. When things are real, I go straight to humor, because that's all I got. Like, it's either that or lose my crap, and I can't.
Like I said, so. Like I said, we are kin spirits, not kindred. We are kin.
I'm just like, yeah. And so we get him in there. They hook him up to IVs to get him some liquid, and that was it. He bottomed out. Last time I looked over, his blood pressure was 80 over 30. And I was like, whoa. And they, you know, he's on a bed. They tip the bed down to where his head's pointing downhill. And I mean, that critical care unit, they ran like a well-oiled machine, and the tone in their voice never panicked him or me, which, I mean, I felt it. I knew, I was like, oh, this is, you know, they got a blood draw, and then they'd come back in, and the next thing, he's got a CPAP mask on, his oxygen's at 87. And I'm like, whoa. And the doc comes in and puts on his gloves. And he goes, he's in kidney failure. He's septic. And his liver. And I was like, what? What? And my husband kind of went gray. And I was like, oh, wow. And I just remember Darren, he looked over at me. And I was like, it's all good, buddy. I said, what are you doing upside down? What's going on? You know, I just kicked right into mom mode. I'm just going to focus on my kid. We're locked eyes, and I'm sitting, pulled my chair up, so I'm face to face with him, and he's got the CPAP mask that he is pissed about, by the way. Blowing all this air, and he's like, and he's trying to take a breath, and he's trying to get it off. And I was like, I said, bud, remember when you were little, because he had migraines, and I'd go in through your nose, out through your mouth. And I'd breathe with him so that he would calm down and listen to my breath. So I'm like, in through your boogers, remember? Out through your mouth. Like when he was little. And then I seen his mouth kind of make the, you know, the motion like he was breathing out, and he simmered down. But I still hear them in the background, and they're like, septic shock. And I'm like, oh, things are real. So they put another IV in to hook up another bag of to just pump fluids into him. And my husband just looked at me, and I was like, I said, buddy, we're going to be right back. Okay. Cause more people are coming in, and they're kind of going underneath of each other and hooking lines up. And I was just like, I'm right here. And I kind of stepped back, so we were away and they could work. And my husband looked at me. He's like, I have to go into the bathroom or something. I said, okay.
You need to go throw up.
And he was gray. And I thought, will you pass out on me now? And I, ooh, don't you do it. And he's like, I heard him say kidney failure. And I was like, yeah, I heard it too. And I was like, I said, go. Cause I'll need you in about 5 minutes when this really just like kicks my butt. And, you know, my son just kept looking at me and I was waving.
I mean, you're expecting severe dehydration, not septic shock, kidney failure.
Not septic shock and kidney failure. No. And he is, his liver was failing.
So basically you heard your kid is dying.
Right in front of my eyes while he's looking me dead in my eyes. And his blood pressure is 80 over 30. That's the last time I looked. I don't even know what we got to, but I know it's bad. It's really bad. And they ended up telling us, you know, that kids, their bodies will compensate and compensate and compensate. They're very resilient. And then as soon as help arrives in the form of IVs, you know, where they're going to hydrate them, they're like, his body was like, oh, help's here. And it just tapped, done. It's out. Everything quit working. And I was like, holy, what the hell? So they had to take a full crew in an ambulance to transport him, which is 90 miles from there, to get to the hospital where we need to go. And so neither my husband nor I could ride in the ambulance with him. It's and there's no service, house. By the way. There's no service in those 90 miles until I get 10 miles closer to the next town. So I have to leave my son at the critical care unit, bottoming out to get there, to be there when the ambulance gets there. And I was like, oh, God, with no service. So if something happened and they end up not being able to take him, I wouldn't know if... It sucked in every way possible. Yeah. So I called my brother.
So I've just got a question. Why don't you have a CB radio?
We just got cell service like 10 years ago.
Yeah, but even when we had cell service in our hometown, I still had a CB.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm going to get a satellite phone. I don't know.
That's what I was thinking with sat phone.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, yeah, a lot of hunters and stuff have satellite phones here, which is a good idea because from town, there's nowhere to go, but even further in the middle of nowhere. And my husband's an avid hunter. So I'm like, I just need to know which direction to send search and rescue. If you don't come back.
And,
like,
and it's like as docile and timid as deer can be, they could still fuck you up. Seriously,
especially
fuck you up.
Another story,
especially
yes,
during rutting season. Yeah. Rutting season, they'll get you.
Sounds like Carrie has another story.
I'm like, that's another time, but yes, they will. Their little back legs are very powerful.
And they could still fuck you up with those antlers too. It's not maybe. Oh, yeah. Not, yeah, they then they will.
Yeah,
they'll lower that head.
At you and when they blow air out their nose, they're not saying hi. They're coming in hot. That's all I got to say about it.
They call it a buck snort for a reason. And no, it's not just a fart.
Oh, cars are going by. Sorry, I'm just taking out in the yard because it's a nice day today.
Oh, it looks gorgeous out there.
It is beautiful. Snow melted. Now I have leaves. I'm like, we just won't look at that. Maybe it'll snow again. Or after eight.
All right, so now he's being raced away in an ambulance.
Well, they're trying to get him stable to take him in an ambulance. Ooh. And I was like, oh, so that we needed respiratory. They needed, you know, another, it's Thanksgiving. They have a skeleton crew and I mean, I'll give him props. They 100% saved his life. They were on it quick and got him stable. And I called my brother who's in the town we live in. So he's 25 miles away. And because I was like, you know, buddy, we're going to have to go ahead of you. Do you want grandpa to come, you know, to be here with you? Because we're going to go and we have to. And he's like, he just looked at me like I just asked him to eat poop. He's like, what? We love grandma and grandpa. We do. But he didn't. He's like, is Audrey? And he just said Audrey, which is his niece or his cousin. And I was like, you got it. And I don't care who I got to call. They're coming. I don't care if it's Thanksgiving. Somebody's coming. So I called and my brother answered. And I was like, what are you doing? He's
like, hey, brother.
He starts going into a deer hunting story because I just got back and I'm all, shut up right now. Listen to me. I need you. And I lost it because I went out in the parking lot and I ended up throwing up in the parking lot. While
you finally had a chance to get in your feels a little bit.
Yeah, I got away from my son and I went out and I was like, okay, mama, what do we do? We got to get this. We got to get things in line. And when I said, I need you to come right now. And he's like, what's up? And lost it. And then I threw up and I was like, I'm like, I'm puking. You guys, right now. And that's the last, he hung up and I was like, where'd he go? 11 minutes. 11 minutes later, my brother
he
was there.
And
I was
like,
I thought he was in the town. I thought he was in the next town over where we were actually at because it was 11 minutes. I was like, and man, he comes screeching in sideways and he jumped out and I was like, hey, and he yelled, F you, because I he didn't even see me. He just, somebody was trying to stop and he was like, nope. And then he went. And I was like, there he goes. And I was on the phone with my dad and I was, and he's like, you know, your brother will be, he'll be there shortly. And I was like, oh, he's right there. And my dad's like, he can't be. And I'm like, well, yeah.
He had that thing floored the whole way.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, his sister needed him.
Yeah. And he went through, and the critical care unit's on the other side of that town, by the way. And I was like, you're so lucky that you're not pulled over because then you wouldn't be here, idiot. I love you. Thank you. So, you know, my husband and I left, and like at the time this was all going on, like any parent knows, you're right there like, okay, what's next, what do we do? You don't think about, this is the last time I could see my son. You don't think that's all the process later.
That
comes later when everything's done. You're like, whoa, that, you know,
that was scary. So, after the fact,
yeah. And so that's kind of what I'm tailing down from right now. So forgive me if I just get a little weepy. I'm like, ooh, it's real, okay. Still.
I told people to bring their tissues, and I'm sitting here trying my best. There's been a couple times where I'm like feeling myself moistening up in the eyes.
Don't make my eyes leak. I just got the eyelash out of it. So, yeah, my son, I was like, buddy. I said, dude, we dodged a bullet. We're getting out of here. We're going to the, you know, and because I'm not necessarily a huge fan of the critical care unit from previous experiences, but they saved my son's life, and it couldn't have been, I couldn't ask for anything better or better care. Angels were just laid in our path from the moment we took him to the hospital, just angel after angel after angel. And looking back at it now,
it sounded like they knew that they suspected the right thing right off the bat.
They did. Yeah. And they just, I mean, one person's hooking up an IV here, another person's, you know, injecting stuff in the IV on the other arm, and they just, like, one lift his arm up and the other guy'd go underneath of him, and they were just smooth. And it just, I mean, they worked fast but not frantic, and
like a pit crew.
Yeah, it was wild. When I think about it now, I'm like, wow, that was impressive. And I still haven't made it down to visit them. I emailed the CEO when I got home and told him how unbelievable that our ER was that day, and I said I'd like to meet them. I don't remember one person's name, and so they gave me the list of who was working that day and worked on my son, and I'll venture down there to see them.
I'm bringing donuts
just right around the building, but I'm not doing it today. And I'll, you know, make my rounds down there, but after, it's just a lot to process, and I know I'm going to lose my crap as soon as I walk in there, but
and that's, yeah, okay, we, mama.
Right. And so I'm, you know, I told my son, I was like, dude, we're gonna get some Dairy Queen because that's what's in the next town. And I was like, so dad and I are gonna go, Uncle Michael's here, blah 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 blah. I was like, we'll see you there, dude. And I was like, hang tough, buddy, and love you. We'll be there when you get there. And it had snowed the night before, and it was the first kind of real sketchy weather. And 90 miles doesn't mean, like, you know, 90 flat, straight, easy driving miles.
Some you of the live in some mountainous of the area.
Nowhere land. And so the ambulance driver said, he's like, just promise me one thing, don't try to keep up with me, okay? And we're like, okay, all right. We got about 10 miles from the next town, which I rode in the car on my knees facing out the back window waiting for lights. I just need to see the lights. I'm like, where are they? Where are they? I knew this. I knew it was going to happen. Something's going to happen, and they're not going to be able to come, and they can't get hold of us because there's no service. I was like, my poor husband, I'm like, in this godforsaken country where there's no cell service. Like, I was off the rail. And I'm just like looking over the back seat, and I was like, where are they? Where are they? Where are they? Where are they? You know, for 80 miles. It was not okay. And then I could see the lights, and I'm like, oh, there he is. And so I turn around, and then they passed us. Well, and what part number two happened? And I was like, that's my son. I was like, turn on your hazards. Just, I was like, F it, go.
Keep up, like, keep up. Fine. You promised not to. Like, I lied.
I know. And I was like, has my son in there? Was our son? What is it? It just, worst nightmare. But every parent's nightmare was happening right in front of me. And the ambulance turned the corner where I couldn't see him anymore. And it's all a little blurry till I got to the hospital after that, because I started hyperventilating. I was just like, We gotta get there. Well, we gotta get there.
And you understandably went histrionic there, and I mean, and that's not saying that in a bad way. I mean, you understandably were histrionic at that point.
Town we went to when.
Uh oh.
Again, yep.
Yep.
That's pausing for effect, making it extra suspenseful for all of our listeners.
Not fine.
Okay, you're back. You're back. Yay.
Yeah. We lost you for about 15 seconds. Yeah, about 15 seconds. You're good.
The last thing we heard you say was that the ambulance went around a turn out of view, and then you came back.
Oh. Yeah, it went out of view, and I lost it. I was like, that's my son. We gotta go. Like, we gotta catch him. And we're doing a pretty good rate of speed where it probably wouldn't have been safe for us to.
Ah, damn it.
Yeah.
That country life. That,
yeah, I was just thinking that rural life. Man, that's,
I'm just sitting there thinking 900.
We didn't even. Yeah, yeah. Well, we're 120 miles away now at this point. Like, we're in the next city where the actual, where there's an ICU, where there's a hospital. And I just.
Ah, damn it.
Yeah. I wonder if we have her.
I was going to see if we could get her to
turn off video.
Or move to a better location closer to the router.
Well, if she.
Through the. Escort us upstairs.
Hey, Carrie?
Yes.
We have lost you three times now in like the last minutes.
Okay, I'm moving closer this way.
Okay. It's either that or maybe shut off the video because it helps with the audio that way, but I like seeing you!
Yeah. I have Starlink! Elon Musk, don't let me down now. We'll get closer to the box.
Meanwhile, my yellow lab's sitting here trying to get me to play fetch with her.
Yeah.
Oh, my dog got a dick hitting me with it.
I'm sitting on my porch, and my dog's whining at the front door like, you're not allowed to be out there without me. Why am I in here?
Is that better?
Oh, much. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. The Wi-Fi box is closer to the house. Sorry.
No worries.
No, you're good.
All right.
All right, so let's go ahead and back up, if it's okay, to you lost it after you couldn't see the ambulance, because it's been really spotty since that point.
I'm going to go sit next to the Wi-Fi box now. Yeah. I forgot I'm in God's country in the middle of nowhere.
There is an issue if you get too close to the Wi-Fi that it becomes overpowering.
You're killing me. You're killing me, Smalls.
That movie turned 30 years old just yesterday, by the way.
No.
Yeah.
That's wild. Oh. Sorry, chubby kid stuck in the couch.
That's my entire life.
I'm on a diet, so I'm starting to remember what it's like to be able to get out of a couch without two tries.
Right? Yeah. Well, now you know how us pregnant girls feel when we get up out of the couch. We're like, help.
You got to need the rock to give yourself momentum.
Yeah. Forward, back, and up.
Yeah. Just dangle some chocolate. We'll get up. Sorry, my husband was in here. I'm like, I was too far from the Wi-Fi box. I kept losing me, and I forgot. I was like, oops. Where was I at? Oh, we're in the emergency room, huh?
Well, no, we weren't quite there. You lost it when the ambulance went out of view.
Oh, the ambulance went out of view. Yeah.
You weren't quite driving safe.
We weren't driving safe, you know, and my husband's not the right color, so I probably shouldn't be yelling at him to go faster. I was like, ooh, this is real. And then there was, you know, we pulled into the emergency room, now 120 miles of straight panic away. And I ran in and was just frantic with the lady at the desk. He was like, can I help you? Yeah. Like right now would be great. Thanks. Like my son just came. This is his name. And he just like, I said, the ambulance just passed us, lady. He just got here. She's like, hold on. She calls and she goes, someone will be right here. And I was like, just tell me where to go.
This is the same issue my dad had when I was being born. Cause my mom was, had to have a life flight to Medford because of placenta previa and was dying. And my dad was at the hospital in Medford trying to find my mom, but they were so busy trying to save her, they didn't have time to register her yet. So,
yeah. And I looking back now, I'm like, thanks for your patience. If I was an a-hole, it was an accident. I didn't mean it. Sorry. But so there, she's like, someone's coming right now. And I'm like, okay. So, and it was a pilot for life flight. Well, my son wasn't life flighted. He was taken by an ambulance. So when a guy comes down in a, you know, in a pilot, first responder, you know, I was like, oh shit. Oh no. And he's like, Mr. and Mrs. Denton, follow me. And I'm like, oh, fuck. And my guts just dropped. And I was like, oh my God. And so we follow him. We get out of the waiting room to the hallway and we start walking. And I took a deep breath and I said, is he alive? Because it just felt bad. It felt bad. And he was quiet. And I was just like, and I said, is he alive? And he said, yes, ma'am. I was like, oh my God. Okay. All right. So we follow him and we get, you know, closer to his room because I heard somebody say, he's got the parents. Move. He's got the parents. And I'm like, oh shit. You know, like, and so people are getting out of the way because they were waiting for us to start working on him. And so the doc and I, and there's my little poopsie pants son. Just, oh God bless him. And he's got that CPAP mask on, still pissed, still trying to get his hand in there. So they have his hand strapped down.
And I'm so like, oh. His body may be almost broken, but his spirit is far from it.
Yeah. And so I walked right up, right past. There was a doctor and seven nurses and a pilot in there. And I was like, whew. And I just walked right up and like, I'm so close to the mask of his CPAP. And I was like, hi, buddy. You beat us. We sure did try. You were hauling balls. And I'm just talking to him. Doc's talking to me. I don't hear you. I'm locked eyes with my kid. And I was like, you were hauling balls, dude. Blah, blah, you know, and I'm just, and he's smiling. He's just looking at me and kind of nods because he's pretty drugged up. And the only thing I heard the doc say was, we'd like to intubate him. And I was like, oh, wait, what? I'll pay attention now. What'd you say? And
yeah.
And he's trying to explain that his body's working really hard. And if they can relieve any work that his body is doing, you know, it takes effort to breathe. It takes effort to digest. It takes energy. Your body uses all of these things that you don't feel, but he needs every ounce that he's got. So they'd like to take some of that, you know, energy.
So we'll want to breathe.
They'd like to relieve
for him.
Some of that. Yeah. So they want it. And he's like, Mom, this is the best way for us to work on him. And that's all. And I go, okay. Okay. And he goes, okay, well, you have 5 minutes. We'd like to get started. What? And he kind of, everyone cleared the room and we had 5 minutes with my kid. And At the time, I didn't think, like,
no, honestly,
legit could be the last time I talked to you. At the time, I was just like, ooh, we touched a bullet there, bud. Here we are.
Giving you 5 minutes tells you that they are at least confident enough that they can do something and that it's not immediately life-threatening.
I imagine there's not a whole lot of thinking going on in that situation. You're just very present, very in the moment. Only thing that matters is keeping your son calm. Yeah, I'm a parent myself, and like whenever my kid's in crisis, or when she was little, you know, or even my girlfriend's son now, it's you know, nothing else matters. You're not really thinking ahead. You're dealing with what's right in front of you. You know, you're not really capable of that forethought, especially when it comes to calming them down.
It's like an instinctual thing almost. You don't even have to think about it. You go parent mode. You're like, boom, 100%. Robotic. Because your child looks at you to see how they need to react. Yeah. They look at you for what's up. Is this bad? Is it good? They look to you for how they should feel. And so I wanted my son to, and I've been that way since he was little.
It's like when he bumps his head when he was a kid. Right, kids looking at you like, should I panic? Did that hurt?
Yeah, like internally, you're like my baby, but externally, you're like, you're safe.
Yeah, you're like, whoa, you came in hot, bud. That was awesome. You know, little red mark, put your hands up. Like, we're gonna stop the bleeding. This, you know,
you're conscious. Yeah. You're not bleeding, and nothing's broken. Okay, we're good.
Yep, we're golden. And then. Yeah, and I was like, dude, you're going to get the best sleep ever. You're going to take a little nap there. And I said, and we're going to be right here. And I just kept saying, we're going to be right here. We're right here. And they came back in. I was like, I love you, buddy. And he's nodding. And I was like, and holding his hand that was strapped down. And he, you know, and my husband was like, I love you. And I was like, we're going to be right here. Okay, right here. And I just backed up. And then they shut the door. And then I was like, this is so bad. We went down to the waiting room and I just held onto the windowsill in the waiting room and I felt like I was just going to collapse. And I was looking out the window.
I got to ask you a question. How many kids do you have?
I just have the one.
So this is just quite literally your baby.
My baby. Yeah. And I had a hard time having him. So we didn't think we could have kids. So, I mean, I'm a smother before this ever happened, like smother the hell out of that kid from the minute he was born.
So he's your miracle baby.
Yeah. Twice now, bless his heart.
He's giving you a, like, my dad has 9 brothers and sisters. He's giving you the 9 kid treatment in one kid.
Oh man, is he ever in a good reason to drink? Yeah.
Meanwhile, I'm drinking this. I'm drinking water and soda. I just donated plasma, so I'm trying to rehydrate and keep my.
Oh, I was like, awake. Are you recouping? No.
From donated plasma, I am. Yeah.
That's awesome. I'm actually an O negative, so they're always after my blood.
I'm O positive, so they're still going after mine pretty hard too.
Nice. Well, I appreciate that. My son had to have a platelet transfusion, whatever they call it, the T word. I did indulge last night, so I am tired. Sorry.
It was Friday night.
He had to have blood, and I mean. So the doctor kept coming in, and this is the wildest thing because, I mean, we're just in shock because I just remember turning to my husband, and I was like, this is really bad. This is really bad. And he's like, I know. And, you know, I had probably a 2-minute really good, ugly, like snot bubble Kardashian ugly cry.
I hear snot bubble cry, and I only think of is Blair Witch Project.
Yeah. You know, a good solid 2 minutes of just, and then I just kind of, I always go, whoo, shake that off. And I just like shake my arms. I'm like, whoo, shake it off. We got it. I said, we need to nut up. I'm like, right now, I'm like, okay. So they got him intubated and we got to go back there. And he had three IV stands and 11 bags of stuff running into him and machine. I was just like, oh my God. And, you know, this tube, and It took my breath away, and then parent mode, boom, there we are. I was robotic. rock star status. I just was like, all right, what's next? What are we doing? And I was, we're on to the next now. Okay, we got here. We're in the ICU. We've got him intubated. We are on our way. We're actually where there is help. Like, and okay. And the doctor, and he's like, has he eaten any raw meat? Has he done this? Because they said he's an anomaly right now and doctors don't like that. So they were talking to people in New Jersey. We had a Denver consult. They called and, you know, phoned a friend, whatever they did. And it was phenomenal. But it took 24 hours. Cultures. We have to wait for cultures to grow. We don't have time for that. Like, it's like, what? No. Don't you have like a Men in Black gun, like, doop, and you can just tell what's wrong with him. I need to know these things.
It's like, where's the Star Trek tricorder thing, the medical
one? Yeah, we put a man on the moon. How do you not know? But he's like, has he eaten any raw meat? He's like, boys do stupid things. So I'm on the phone with his friends. I'm like, has he drank, smoked, ingested, eaten, bitten, anything? Nothing's too small. I need to know anything this child's done in the
Did
last
he
week.
Bite something or did something bite him?
Yeah, I'm like,
did it bite back?
16, so I'm like, is he vaping? Is he like, no one's going to get in trouble. I need to know. And they're like, no, and Darren doesn't do that. And no. And I was like, has he bitten the head off a fish or rock? I don't know. Has he sacrificed a chicken? I need to know.
Did he go Ozzy Osbourne and bite the head off a bat?
Yeah, these are the things they're asking us. Has he eaten raw meat? I'm like, not that I'm aware of. The most bizarre one we got, because the doctor had come in and come out, and they were a little more frantic. They were in and out, and asking us all these questions. And he's like, has your son run over a gopher or a mole with a riding lawnmower lately? What?
I mean, no, doesn't sound like it wouldn't be all, I mean, sounds kind of fun, but no.
I just paused and I go, can that kill you? What? And my husband
the
is like,
getting revenge.
I mean, what do you think we do up there? It's not like whack-a-mole. I mean, I don't know what you mean. And my husband is like, he shot a gopher the other day, but he didn't eat it. I'm back now. It's kind of funny. But at the time we were like, what? And
I can only think of fear of rabies or something.
Yeah.
He killed it over, but he didn't eat it. Like,
this sounds like a How Country is Country joke. Like,
oh man.
You know?
It was wild. And he said,
canned possum with squirrel gravy.
Right?
Do you live with an infestation of rats? And I'm like, no.
They're thinking black plague.
So they're thinking from E. coli, Hantavirus, you name it. They were testing this child for it because they have no idea what's got him into.
But I'm just thinking about the symptoms that you've given and what those questions about rodents. I'm thinking they're thinking of the fleas carrying black plague or bubonic plague.
Oh man, they
because I mean
him,
that still exists. California has one of the hottest areas for plague.
Yosemite.
They tested him for mold, for fungus, for, you know, whether this is a viral. I mean, obviously it's bacterial because there's something in his blood. And he said this is rare, but your son's rare. So we're testing him. There's something you can get from muskrats. I don't know. I quit listening after that. I was like, what? Test him for whatever. I don't
care. They're grasping at straws at that point.
Test if he's pregnant. I don't care. Find out what's wrong with him. Like, fix him.
That's got to be terrifying when you figure out what you realize that the doctors are playing Where's Waldo, you know, the Where's Waldo version of sickness and stuff. Like, these are the people who went to school for 12 years. Why don't they know?
You know? And can we call Dr. House?
We don't know. And right? I'm like, why don't you know? Because I know you paid good money for school. You need to know.
At the same time, there's literally tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of diseases. So it's an elimination game.
I was like, we're gonna play, you know, process of elimination. Okay, well, I don't care what we play as long as you fix him.
As long as you're winning the game.
Yeah, process of save my son.
Right.
As long as we're making progress, I don't. Just tell me he's gonna be okay, and nobody insinuated that he wasn't, and nobody at all even hinted that he was going to be. I mean, it was
liability wise, they can't tell you he's going to be okay.
Yeah, and they have good game faces. They just stared at us, and I was like, all right.
Austin, no. You're muted if you wanted to say something.
Ooh. Just talking to my kid.
Oh, okay.
I was like, oh, we lost him this time. Oh, yeah.
Well, he lives out in the sticks. Not quite like you, but he does live out in the sticks.
Yeah, my closest store is only 20 minutes away.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah. Taco Bell's 25. Not to rub it in.
My Taco Bell's 120. That's mean.
I can walk to my nearest Taco Bell.
Yeah.
See, he's always been rude. Always. Did you hear that? Yeah. Walk to it, he says.
You know what? He can keep his big city life. I grew up in San Francisco. I moved to Sacramento because I wanted a smaller feel. And then I was like, this is still too many people. And now I have 8 houses on my block that's a quarter mile long. And I'm like, nice. Maybe a little more rural than this even would be good. So
hey, I know a place. I know a place.
I like the suburbs. I do like the suburbs. I would like a little more rural. Like, I wouldn't mind having where you're at, to be completely honest.
Yeah. But I got 3 acres.
Do not try to put me in a downtown. I hate it. I am just a ball of stress and anger the entire time I'm downtown anywhere.
Yeah.
Yeah, your anxiety, you're like, you're close, you're not in your lane, what's happening, get away from me.
My bubble is as far as my fist can fly. Don't enter it.
Yeah. Yeah, he probably has more people in his, like, within just like a 3-block radius than you have in your whole town. Yeah. You know?
Nice. Yeah. Nice.
Hey, but I got a karaoke bar within walking distance of my place.
Now, see, that's what I'm talking about right there.
I don't need a karaoke bar. I got a shower. That's enough for me.
You're better there.
There you go.
All right. But, so,
sorry, we go off track.
Yeah, he's intubated. He has tubes running everywhere, wires everywhere. I'm assuming at this point he's unconscious because intubating while awake is not a very good thing.
So they have to put him in an induced coma.
Yeah. Okay. And you know, he's intubated on a ventilator, and just so his body has to do absolutely nothing on its own.
But heal.
Just nope. But heal. But first, we got to find out what we're treating. And I mean, I didn't ask. The nurse would come in and I'd be like, how's he doing? She's like, okay. That's all I wanted to know. That's it. I don't want to know what that is. Like, I don't want to. I don't have the brain.
Is he stable? Is he not getting worse? Is he stable?
We didn't have any regression, is what they would say. We didn't regress. And I'm like, that's all I can ask for.
Yeah.
We're not going backwards. And 24 hours later, we found out it was strep, group A strep. You know, get it in your throat, have a throat lozenge, go about your business. That's what's in his blood. And they don't know how it got there. He had double lumbar pneumonia. Lungs are full. He didn't even have a rasp or a cough or anything the whole time. He was, you know, had flu-like symptoms, but his lungs are full. The x-rays were horrendous. And I was like, how is he even breathing? He was using the upper lobe of his right side and the upper lobe of his left, and not much space of that was he using to breathe.
How did he not come and say, hey, I'm having a hard time breathing?
Because he said he didn't. He wasn't having a hard time breathing. He's not a complainer.
At the same time, it could be that, you know, as you were saying, once your body, as a child, you get that help, maybe the fluid rushed into the lungs once he got that IV.
Right, because, I mean, well, when we, I think, yeah, because his 87 was his oxygen. And, I mean, and that's, you know, not great.
But that's not.
But
like,
it's not like 60, you know.
Right,
I mean,
right.
But
well, yeah, I mean, 87 is like COPD, you know.
Yeah, it was. Yeah. And then they came back the next day and said he's got a 6mm by 7mm vegetation inside the pulmonary valve of his heart. And I was like, what?
What does vegetation mean? I'm thinking
a loogie ball, like a. It's like a big loogie. Group A strep that is on the inside.
I hear that,
and
I'm thinking like he has a flower garden growing in. You know, I hear vegetation. I'm like, you know,
just pull up the carrots, damn it!
Yeah, right? So like vegetation growth, and I was like, what does that mean? They're like, And they said, has he had any heart injuries? Does he have heart? I was like, no, he's had nothing. Like, oh, I don't know what this means. And he said, it's just really rare. You know, at times we heard the words, he's really rare. I got it. Yep.
Yeah.
One of them. He's an endangered species. I got it. But so they said, you know, things like that usually land on the weakest organ in your body, or artificial, like if you have a hip, you know, something right. foreign in your body. So for it to land on the right side of the pulmonary valve of his heart, there are 36 cases where group A strep in your blood has caused endocarditis in the right pulmonary valve of a heart. 36. Any of those are IV drug users. And I'm like,
how many of those were IV? You kind of broke up. How many?
Over 20 of them. So they have a 36 person, you know, study group for this.
So only 16 or less were not intravenous drug users.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And they kept saying to me, I was like, listen, he killed a gopher. Like, I don't know. And so they're like, can you fix him? Like, can you fix him? So the group A strep threw him into toxic shock syndrome. And so he had toxic shock. And so then, you know, inflammation, because your body's trying to heal itself, full-blown septic shock. So he really got the shock from both sides of it. He's in toxic shock and septic shock, which I now know are two very different things. One's caused from the bacteria, and the other one's caused from inflammation from your own body trying to save itself, that it tries to kill what's, you know, infected, which is your heart and your lungs and your liver and your kidneys. And so septic shock is your body trying to kill you because it thinks, you know, it doesn't register that that's you. It just registers that that's invader. Infected and we got to attack it. And that's what sepsis is. So that's what my biggest fear is now, is the aftermath. They said 75% of septic survivors that are in septic shock end up in the hospital within 3 months, because it's very easily for your body. You can work out too hard and the inflammation markers go up and your body's like, oh, I remember this. And you know,
so basically your body's like, I thought I told you to stay down.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, I can imagine it's like really hard it's got to be really hard for you to not wrap your child now in bubble wrap, you know, and it makes sure bubble boy. You know, yeah. Like,
if I could go to school with him, I would. I would sit at his desk with him every day. Drink your water. Here you go. Let me love you. Yeah.
And this is just this last Thanksgiving. So we're talking just months ago.
Yeah, we got home. We got home on Christmas morning at 1 o'clock in the morning from Seattle, which we're getting there.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Oh, by the way, if anyone is interested, Carrie has documented all of this. On Facebook, yes, has a special page, Darren's Journey. I followed that, and every single day that there was an update, I was reading it to my wife. My wife is a surgical nurse.
So was she baffled, too? Because I got a lot of messages from people going, has he had dental procedures? Has he had this? I'm like, he ran over. He shot a gopher. No, he's had
dental procedures. She was just like, look, this is not my area of expertise, but keep it coming. She's like, I really care. Like, she got really invested in the story, too. Again, I mean, you're one of the best friends I've had. So obviously this journey really impacted me. Like let's call it sympathy distraught. I was freaking out that entire time too, while you were going through hell. I would like to think I took some of that from you, but unfortunately I think I just contributed.
Well, you did take it from me, all the messages and the things that I got. And I started the page.
I mean, you and I, we talked a number of times during that, too. Yeah. Just talked.
I was like, whoa, things are real. And once we figured out it was just bad news after bad news. Okay, it's group A strep. And I'm like strep throat. And they're looking at his toe from where he Tom Cruised across my living room in his socks. Entertainment center and has a blood blister.
He did a risky business slide.
Yeah, and stubbed his toe. He has a blood blister on his toe, and no, it's not infected. There's no, it's just very pretty little purple blood blister. And they kept looking at the blood blister, and a friend of mine, a near and dear friend of mine, came down to the hospital and stayed with me and overnight, and just in case we needed anything. And she's like, why are they looking at his toe strip is in your throat? And I was like, not when it's in your blood, apparently. You know, so like, they think that's possibly where the strep entered his body, was through the blood blister. You have strep on your under your toenails. Everyone has it under their fingernails. And a lot of people get, like, if you do get strep in your blood, the membranes inside of your nose are very, very fragile and very tender, and you have strep under your fingernails.
Pick your nose and get strep.
Strep from picking their nose. Yeah. And it's your own strep. And he, you know, the doc told us he could have, so he could have popped the blood blister, and it's, you know, not, it just looked like a normal, his toe wasn't even really swollen or anything. And he said, takes his socks off, goes to his friend's house, pulls a blanket up over the top of him, and sleeps on the couch. And I was like, what? And he goes, it's that scary. That's very easily. So we have to get rid of his shoes, socks, bed, everything. Because strep will live for 6 months on surfaces. So I was like, what? And he's like, it could come, your breath, you can't see your breath, but there's so many things. If you have, you know, an open line, which a blood blister is, even though it's not gushing blood, or you're not, you know, injecting an IV into a vein, if there's blood, it can get in your bloodstream. It could be a scratch and it can enter your bloodstream. If there's pus or it's infected, that's great because it's pushing stuff out. But if it's just a blood blister, like, legitimately, it's that scary. And I thought,
and for everybody, I just dropped the link to Darren's Journey Home in our Discord server so people can go
Thank
ahead and
you.
Read it and follow along. I know that you wanted to share that, so.
Yeah, it was, I just thought, there's no way this is even real. So if your child ever gets a blood blister, for the love of all that's holy, don't pop it. Don't do it.
And if it pops,
I thought, there's no way.
Clean the damn thing and then give your kids something.
Yeah, cover it. I put Neosporin on it, put a Band-Aid on it. I don't even know. And so, you know, for it to cause endocarditis is where he becomes number 37, because rarely does, you know, a bacteria in your blood cause you to have a growth inside the pulmonary valve of your heart. And I'm like, what? And so there was this amazing angel, very unorthodox angel of a doctor from Denver that was up here. He's like, he looked just like Gru from Despicable Me. He had the smallest waist of any human I've ever seen. Like, I was like, that's a very unfortunately proportioned human right there. Like I said, we hadn't slept in a couple days, so I'm a little delirious, but he's the smallest waisted man I've ever seen with the ginormous upper body. I was like, whoa, what are
Sounds
you?
Like he skipped what? Leg day.
Every day.
Yeah.
It was crazy, and I was so delirious. I was like, ooh, that's unfortunate. And we saw him in the waiting room. I didn't know who it was. And I was like, that's not good, Carrie. You're going to hell. Stop it. Like, you know, I'm like, oh. And then
this is the guy that's going to save your son.
Yeah, I didn't know that at the time. So a couple hours later, he comes into the room and I thought, there's my karma. Here it is, you beautiful, crazy Polish man. And he's like, so the boy. And I was like, oh, it gets better.
Like, he sounds like Rue.
I was like, stop it. Lock it down. Lock it down. You know. And he ended up being the last doctor that my son saw. And he was on his fourth day up here. And he's like, he's from Denver. And he's like, I go back to Denver today. And I was like, okay, cool, neat. And he's like, I just no leave boy here. And I was like, huh? What? And he just came in, said a sentence and would leave. And then he'd come back, say two sentences and leave. And I was like, is he fucking with us? What's happening? Like, I don't even know what's happening right now.
Oh, he's doing his magic when you're not looking.
Yeah. I was like, whoa. So, I mean, my son's getting antibiotics. They're treating the strep, or the group A strep, and getting sepsis. We never had to do dialysis, which is amazing. His kidneys started working, but he was probably 115 pounds when we got to the hospital, and they pumped him full of so much liquid. He was 147 at one point. And we haven't even got to Seattle yet. Like, we're day two. face swollen, eyes swollen shut, which he was in a coma anyway, so we couldn't, you know, he didn't open his eyes or anything. But I was like, can his shin split? Can his skin split? Because he was, I mean, the kidneys were working, but not as fast as the liquid they pumped into him at first to save him. So now
he was basically, he was getting more liquid in than he was getting out.
Yeah. And so, I mean, but that got him to the city, you know, that we were in. And now we have a whole other set of problems, you know, because your heart doesn't like that kind of stuff, doesn't like things weighing on it, you know. And so, I mean, it was just one, like every single move they made was, it was life threatening. Like, do you take the water off too fast? Nope. Nope, nope. Your blood pressure drops, by the way, real fast. And the thing that hurts your organs the most isn't shock. It isn't sepsis. It's low blood pressure. Low blood pressure kills tissues in your organs. And so,
you know, he dropped. The blood pressure, for people that don't know this, I actually had to study this. The blood pressure actually causes the nutrients in the fluids and all that to actually I forgot the exact terminology, but basically it forces it to go into your cells to do what it needs to do and take the toxins out of your cells. Without that pressure, the cell membranes are too strong and nothing gets through. And then the cells start dying because they're starving and full of toxins.
Yeah.
I think it's like pleural I can't remember the exact, term, but yeah, it has, without that blood pressure, yeah, your cells just don't do what they need to do.
Yeah. They just kind of shrivel up. It's like not watering a plant. Yep. And so I was like, ooh. So, and long story short, this amazing Polish Dr. Gru looking guy, he's like, I just don't want to leave him here. He's going to need a pediatric cardiologist, you know, a cardiosurgeon. And because we still have this loogie of group A strep inside our heart. And I was like, oh, that's great. And he's like, there's not many of those here. And I'm like, yeah, there's not anything here. And he said, you know, I call Washington. We talked about Salt Lake City. And he said, worst case scenario, I'll take him home with me. He'll come to Denver with me. And he goes, and I'll buy you dinner. And I'm just sobbing. And I go, I like food. That's all I said. I like food, Doc. But I mean, he's like,
he's taking it personally is what's happening here.
100%. Yeah.
It's amazing when you have a healthcare team that you can tell is personally invested, you know, in their patients, because it's so rare. It's really easy for.
It really is rare.
Yeah. I work in the medical field, and it's really easy for healthcare providers to become kind of numb. You know, it's where I think you get a lot of really bad, you know, bedside manners come from. It's not that they don't care, it's that, you know, they've seen
probably
it all.
Mentally can't.
It's like, it's like you're the 10,000th person that has come in here for this exact thing in my career.
Well, except for, you know, not Carrie's sons.
No, God, no.
No, there's been 36 examples and none
37
of them in
there, now.
37 and none now. In that hospital. Right?
So, no. And we're nowhere near Denver. So this dog is out of area. And the nurse that kept him stable, I was like, my son would get a little agitated if it was loud in there, or if, you know, a buzzer went off, which happened about every couple minutes, you know, and
hospitals are loud.
Yeah. I'd walk over and I'd hold his hand. I'm like, her name was Stephanie. God, I was like, I think she's a robot though. I think like Katy Perry kind of robots, conspiracy theory. This woman was robotic. And she said maybe three words to us in 3 days, but she kept my son. And I was like, Stephanie just won't let she get sleep, will she, bud? You know, and his eyes are closed. And I was like, she's going to find your sweet spot again, buddy. She's got it. And then she'd just, I don't know, twist some knobs, do some things. And then he'd again, because his blood pressure couldn't drop anymore. So the sedation that they had him on was right on the edge of him being awake. But he has to be sedated. And right. He's fighting fentanyl. He's fighting off the Dilaudid. He's fighting off the prop and whatever, you know, that keeps him asleep. And that nurse asked me, was he a redhead when he was born? I was like, yeah. She goes, there's no science behind this, but you ask any nurse and they'll tell you that redheads, they just don't seem to take pain meds. I was like, really? She said, because the nurse was like, he's fighting the fentanyl. I upped it to this and he's not. And I'm like, what's happening? His body was just like, kiss my butt. I want to be awake. But yeah. We needed him to be asleep.
Especially
so that's a little tidbit like for you. I was like, yeah, he's intubated. It's breathing for him. We don't want you opening your eyes. That's some PTSD you do not want, buddy.
Yeah. Well, and that and instant gag reflex. Like it's, you know, you're instantly going to feel like you're choking to death when it's actually not, this is what's keeping you alive.
Yeah. And we're in the adult ICU. We're not in a PICU because it was full. So he's got an adult vent tube in adult size, which they changed out in Seattle to a smaller one. Everything was just bad until this doc, he's like, he comes to Denver with me. I'll buy you dinner. And I was like, and I'll eat it. Okay, here we go. We're going to Denver. And I told my husband, we're going to Denver.
Is it Taco Bell?
Taco Bell, yeah. I'm in. And the doc comes back. He's like, no beds in Washington, but I get what I want. And I was like, I bet you do, you scary, beautiful human. You just get her done. And so nothing. And he comes back and he goes, I do better. I get you the best of the best. And he's already admitted. And the plane is on its way. You're going to Seattle Children's. And I was like, shut up.
Yeah, I mean, that's Seattle,
like, oh my
Seattle
God,
Children's.
Seattle Children's.
It's like Seattle Children's for
Seattle Children's to get us. Seattle Children's Hospital in Seattle.
I was gonna say Seattle Children's Hospital is like the St. Jude's for non-cancer patients.
That is the most amazing. I just want to go and live there. That's big. They'll never even know I'm there. I'll volunteer every day of my life. It is romper room. 11 stories of romper room. It is amazing. That is.
You just
win the lottery,
aged us. You just put an H just by saying romper room.
I know we're old. Well, Barney sucked. I'm sorry. Romper room was better.
Yep, that's where it was at.
With the magic mirror to say happy birthday to all those kids.
Yeah. I mean, everything from the x-ray machine has angel wings on it. And I mean, everything is the murals on every wall. You're in a jungle on this floor, an ocean on this floor. I mean, it is equipped for kids to not be scared. And it is 1,000 equipped for parents to not have to worry about anything but their kid. That place will get every penny that I ever am able to save in my life. I'm going to give it all to them. If I win the lottery, I'll go in there. It's a phenomenal. I can't say enough good things. They're all saints and angels. They all chose that profession. It's not like they couldn't get another job or they're working.
Okay,
they
no,
chose
working
to be there.
Working at Seattle's Children, that is a hard to get job. That is a prestigious job. You have to really want to be there. You don't get to work at the best of the best unless you're one of the best.
Yeah.
And you would never know. There's not an ounce of arrogance. There's not an ounce of they're like kindergarten teachers, but they're so brilliantly, wickedly intelligent. And they're godsend angels, saints and angels, all of them. I told everybody they're clear down to security and the overzealous guy at 7 a.m. at Starbucks. I even told him, you're a beautiful human. Thank you so much. Because I just the day they took my son's vent tube out was my birthday. And I thanked every single worker that I came across, and security was super happy to hear it because no one likes security. I was just like, saints and angels, all of you. This has been the most phenomenal experience. And Darren's case was so rare that every doc or surgeon or anyone that came in had a student with them, which was cool because I was like, do you mind if we bring a student? I was like, absolutely not. Yeah, come on in. Bring them, you know, learn whatever you can. If you need anything,
like, this, you may save a life with what you learned today.
Yeah.
It was wild. But yeah, so Dr. Gru tells us, I call him Dr. Gru. That's not his name, but he looked like Gru. I can't pronounce his name. Started with C, ended with a Z. I'm not sure. But he's like, plane is on its way. Pack your bag. And I was like, I don't have a bag. I mean, I left Thanksgiving morning.
You just thought you were going to the critical care unit, getting him his fluids, getting a band-aid and that was it.
I didn't have
there was
socks
no
on.
Thought. There was no thought. There's no thinking of just it. It was my son. That was the entirety of your thoughts, I'm sure, you know.
Yeah.
But I mean, even then it was like, you know, he's breathing on his own, he's moving on his own, he's in good spirits. Yeah. We're just gonna get here, get some fluids, find out he has the flu, get a prescription. Go fill it, go home. That's probably where your mind was going in.
We're Mario Kart with a wheelchair at the critical care, like I did not. And so as a parent, even though the doctors told me, they're like, listen, there's not a parent on earth of a 16-year-old who has flu-like symptoms that is going to think, we should go to the hospital. I bet you have toxic shock in your septic. Cause I was like, the whole time his back hurt. He wasn't dehydrated. His kidneys are failing. Like, he's in kidney failure. And so in my head flashes back, you know, him laying on the couch, and I see him, and it's just like, oh, hey. And I'm trying to feed him water and he's fucking dying. And I'm like, oh my God. And that was probably
okay.
So, and I know there's nothing I could have done, and I did, but as a parent, you just still you know, you have one job, one thing that's the most important to you in the whole world, and it's protect your baby. And now you're looking at him, and you can't. There's another level of helpless that comes from, helpless has got to be the worst part of all of this, is to literally not have any control or any foresight of, like, I can't protect him. I can't do anything. There's a tube breathing for him. I have to trust Dr. Gru. I was just like, oh my God. And that is the most gut-wrenching feeling.
I still remember my little girl, my youngest daughter. She's 7 now, but when she was only days old, we thought that she had a seizure, and she wound up being in Davis Children's Hospital for 3 days, and we couldn't hold her.
Yeah. That's the worst. Yeah.
That was that's a rough 3 days. Your newborn.
Yeah, you can't
laying.
Be close to their face. You can't, like, you can't.
Oh, I could hold a hand. That was all I could do.
I could hold a hand. Yeah. Yeah, and it's strapped down, and you just hold their hand, and you're like, I'm here, useless, but I'm here. It was just gut wrenching. So yeah, from the time he was intubated until we saw his eyes open and he knew we were there was Thursday, Friday, Saturday, 3.5. No, Saturday night. He opened his eyes and looked at us. I'm like, hi, buddy. And I just got right up in his face. We were actually getting off the ambulance in Seattle at Seattle Children's. And he was, you know, coming to, and this nurse kept asking me, who was an IV drug user, and I've been super pleasant for 2.5 days now to everyone. I just was in a zone, but this lady was getting on my nerves. And I was like, I didn't even feel irritated at all until she was there, but it's because my son's waking up and I haven't seen him. I haven't seen his eyes open in days. And
I'm assuming he's waking up close to him too soon at this point.
So, and that's what I was thinking. I was like, oh, I mean, they kept him heavily sedated on the plane ride, which Seattle sent over. Oh, bless that place. And and she's like, are you sure he's not an IV drug? I'm like, listen, you don't know where we live. We live in a town of 900 people. It might be common for 16-year-olds to be IV drug users here, but they are not where I come from. Like, just listen, I need to see his face. You got to get away from me. Like, it's like, lady pants. And then every human being we encountered changed our course and changed our path. And just, they were angels because we could take one person on the plane. So Dr. Gru left. I was like, oh, we're going to Seattle. And a lady came in right behind him. She's like, ma'am, what do you weigh? We need it for flight information. I'm like, oh, you mean like right now? We're going to Seattle right now? Okay.
Yeah,
like,
the plane's on the way. As soon as they land, they need
plane's
know how
much, on the way.
They need to know how much fuel to put in the plane.
Yeah. And so that's what hour later, I'm on a tarmac, you know, just getting out of the ambulance with my son. And I was like, you know, going out to get on the plane.
You got to do something that very, very few people get to do in the United States in this post 9/11 era. You were on a tarmac.
Yeah. They didn't even check my bag. No, I'm just so, you know, my husband, we're trying to, his mom was down there and they're trying to get him a flight out of this, because I was like, oh, I'm pretty tough, but I can't do this alone. But you know, only one of us can go on the plane, and I'm begging them to take Stephanie, the robotic angel. And she was a traveling nurse from Arizona, I found out. And I was like, God bless her, because she came back 2 days in a row, and there wasn't another nurse we had there that kept him quiet at the sweet level, sweet spot, I called it. And I mean, they were all phenomenal, but I was like, can Stephanie come to Seattle? Do I get Stephanie? I need her. Like, and they're like, well, we do have an extra seat. And I was like, Darren has a dad. He has a dad. If you have an extra seat. And some of the life flight people from Seattle was like, well, I'll check with the pilot. And I was like, are you serious? What's happening? And he came back. He goes, pilot didn't put on as much fuel as we thought. Your husband can go too. And I was like, shut up. Okay, here we go. And that was the first like really good. We're like holding hands. I'm like laughing. I'm like, oh my God, this is happening. We're going to Seattle. And so, I mean, holy crap. And we get out.
Salvation is in Seattle.
Salvation is in Seattle. That means there's hope. I mean, we're going places where, medical research capital, like we're going to Seattle. And the pilot like comes out of the plane, and I'll never forget it. He's all smiles and he looks at us and he goes, hey folks, let's get you to Seattle. And I lost it. I was like, thank you. He shakes my husband's hand and I just like flop on him. I'm like, and so my husband got to ride in the cockpit. He's never been on a plane, so that was new. And
he got to go in the cockpit. That's awesome.
Yeah. Did you see the plane? I posted.
I did.
A picture
I saw
of
pictures
it.
Of it. Yeah.
So it was like an $8 million plane. My husband knows all this because those little earphones they have, so you can hear and talk to everyone. They had four of them. Well, we've got two EMTs, a pilot and my husband. So guess who got earphones but couldn't hear nothing and got to talk to no one? Me, right here. So my plane ride was a very different experience than my husband's. He's in the cockpit. I looked up. He's taking videos. My arm is on my son's leg. He's wrapped in this big old yellow gunny sack, like sleeping bag, all strapped down into bay. I got to watch my son for 2 hours while my husband's taking videos of the scenic view. We had two different flights. And he's like, did you know? And I'm like, no, I didn't. And I don't think you should talk to me right now. So, I had 2 hours of some serious praying, trying to wrap up in my sweatshirt because it was cold as hell. And just staring at my kid and all of the, he had 11 bags of stuff and they came in, unhooked him. It was just like a pit crew again, and had him on these. They looked like battery chargers, like these little boxes and tubes going in, and had him hooked up, boom, zipped up on a little gurney thing. Out we go, and we're through this tunnel. And I was like, this is like out of the movies. This is wild. And they just hung up these little boxes. All of the stuff's there. And I was like, holy crap, this is nuts. And we flew into Seattle, and I was like, this is amazing. And that kid spent the next 6 days intubated on a ventilator, awake, not strapped down, with his own spit sucker swabbing his own mouth, and wouldn't sleep. For the love of God, he wouldn't sleep. But so doctors, nurses, students came in to see the boy awake that is intubated. Hanging out, playing cards with nurses, 5:30 in the morning.
Mm-hmm. Can't talk, but can play cards.
On a dilaudid drip, hooked up. I mean, he was really sick, so he didn't have the right color, and he was very slow, but he had a whiteboard, and he wrote on it, swabbed his own mouth, had his own spit, hit a nurse with the spit sucker when she tried to help him. He whacked her with it and just looked at her, and he's sucking his own mouth. And I was like, yeah. She's like, whoa, he's awake. And I was like, yeah. Don't take a spit sucker. It's going to whack you with it. And, one nurse is like, I've been here 20 years. And I only saw one person awake that was intubated, on a ventilator. It's breathing. He just moved his chest with it, he said, when he finally, And I was like, you're a freak of nature, buddy. Like, you're a freak, dude. Nobody does that. And he's like, I didn't think it was that bad. And I was like, you're a freak of nature.
He's like, wow, it was actually kind of cool doing that.
Yeah, and I was like, whoa. So, we had a lot of visitors to see the boy. And I was like, oh, man. They got the thing in his heart, they blasted it with penicillin. Who knew? Penicillin out of the umpteen hundred antibiotics we had in and out. Penicillin.
Hey, and sometimes the classics are best.
Right? It broke up, and like Bruce Willis, Armageddon blasted, and it broke off of his heart when they started the penicillin, and it broke into four pieces that went into the lower lobe of his lung and got stuck in the bottom and killed that tissue, which is now bleeding. I'm like, what?
What? This was supposed to help, not hurt.
Yeah, and they said, you know, we can treat it better if it's in the lungs. We don't want it in his heart. And I'm like, okay, I trust you. Okay, good. And they said, did you know your son had a hole in his heart? And I was like, how the hell would I know that? And I was like, what? And they said, yes, he has a hole in his heart. And 100% of babies have it.
It's that one.
So there's between the left and right ventricle. And it closes up on most babies.
Yeah, as soon as they're born, it's supposed to be during that contraction being squeezed coming out, that it's supposed to slam that shut permanently.
Yeah. And it's not uncommon for it to not shut and have like a small slit in your heart between the two left and right ventricles. So we found out in Seattle that the right side of his heart was infected with this group A strep. And she said, you know, we would have seen it. It takes a while to go through your body. It's not like your body's on a continuous loop that's really, you know, like you get bit by something, it slowly turns red, you know, and slowly grow. That's how long it takes something to move through your body. So we would have seen signs, you know, in his shoulders or, you know, something as the group A strep went through his body, because your right pumps out and then it filters and your left brings in. Well, that growth in his heart, the group A strep, the caucus mother loving, I had a bunch of words for it. It wasn't good. it allowed it to backsplash kind of, and it went through that hole in his heart and infected his left side of his heart too. That's why shit got real, and it got real fast, because now the blood going in and out is infected with group A, and that's why he went pew, like straight down. Or it wouldn't, it would have been bad, but we would have had a little precursor to it. And so I'm like, you know what, that the little hitchhiker on his heart got us to Seattle, because had he not had that, he had just had pneumonia and an infection, and we probably wouldn't have gotten to Seattle. And had we not gotten to Seattle, we probably would have never known he has this hole in his heart, which now we're aware of. So, like, it was all bad, but it all led to, holy crap, this is insane. So, I mean, we'd have never known he had the hole in his heart. We would have never known those things, and we'd have never got to Seattle without that hitchhiker, because the hitchhiker on his heart jumped ship as soon as we got there. And I was like, they're like, well, you probably shouldn't. We were in the cardio ICU at Seattle Children's, which I think they just kept him there instead of moving him to infectious disease, which is who we were ultimately treated by, because he played cards with nurses at 5 a.m, intubated. They loved coming to see him because this is new for them. They haven't seen a kid awake, miserable, wash rags on him and fans and just sick. But he wrote on a whiteboard as they were taking him to get a chest tube to get the fluid off. He wrote, "Don't kill me," on his whiteboard and showed the nurse. And I was like, and I'm like, Darren. And he just gave her a thumbs up as she looked at him. Her name was Sherry. She'd been with us. And he's like, "Don't kill me." And I was like, "Darren." And she's like, "Oh, Darren, silly." She's like, "If I was going to kill you, I would have already." And I was like, "Oh, my God." His board around, and he erases it with his hand. He had a blue hand the whole time from his dry eraser marker, and he wrote, "Just checking," and held it up and gave her a thumbs up. And I was like, this kid is gonna make me pull my hair out.
He's just being a kid. Being a kid.
Waller's machine
going through some pretty traumatic stuff and maintains his sense of humor. Like, that's awesome.
The that whole is
time, like, "What's wrong with you, Mom?" And I'm just like, like, teetering on the edge.
He's like, "Mom, it was just a joke. I thought you were okay with humor in stressful situations."
Yeah, and I'm like, I mean, it was just weird seeing him with, you know, all this stuff coming out of his mouth's open. There's a machine breathing, you know, and he can't, but he's still my kid. I mean, I still didn't get to hug him, but I got to see his face, you know, and I'm like, and we'd hold hands and he'd watch Netflix. And I was like, God, this is wild. That kid didn't sleep, but maybe the longest he slept one night was 4 hours. And the nurses are like, he slept 4 hours. We didn't even take vitals at 2. We just backed on out of the room. I was like, why is he not sleeping? Because your kid asks you to play Uno at 1 a.m. and he's on a vent tube. You don't get to say no. Mommy's tired.
Also, he's 16, probably a very active kid. Being stuck in bed, he's just this ball of energy that it needs to go somewhere, so he stays awake.
He wanted his phone.
Yeah, I got an infection in my hand. It was galvanization poisoning when I was 18. And I wound up being hospitalized for 3 days. I slept for maybe 2 hours that whole time because I hiked Black Butte every day. Yeah. I was assistant coach for my sister's softball team. I was riding my bike everywhere. I played soccer. I did taiko. I was a super active kid. So to be stuck in that bed, yeah, I couldn't sleep. I had too much energy. I couldn't burn it.
He's on a dilaudid drip. The kid was high as hell. But I was like, buddy. They resorted to giving him melatonin in an IV. And I was like, well, if dilaudid's not doing it, I don't think that melatonin's going to do much. Give her a shot. Go right ahead.
Well, it can't hurt.
It can't hurt. And then so they did that. And like 2.5 hours later, I'm like, why are you awake? And he just shrugged and looked at me and went back to watching Netflix. I'm like, all right, well, fair enough. Okay, we're awake. It was, damn kid. He was FaceTiming with my parents. He can't, so he's writing on the board and stuff. And they're like, well, hopefully you'll be home by Christmas and think about what you want for Christmas. And my son writes on the whiteboard, is now a bad time to ask for truck parts? And my husband looks at him and he goes, now's the perfect time, buddy. Now's the perfect time. Like, oh, what is even happening? So, I mean, it sounds crazy, but it was fun. The last week we were at Seattle Children's, they, like I said, got his vent tube out.
I still remember seeing pictures of him all machined up, out playing catch with the football with your husband.
That was 24 hours after they took the vent tube and he got off the ventilator. That kid walked outside. We got to surprise him because he was like, I don't be playing basketball soon. And still writing on a whiteboard about 24 hours later because his throat hurt.
Well, yeah.
Really bad. And he didn't talk for a day after he got the vent tube out. And when he did talk, he said it was like swallowing hot nails. So he didn't talk. We ate a lot of Otter Pops and the kid hadn't eaten in 14 days. He ate everything, but nothing tasted the same to him. He's like, it all tastes like burnt metal. And the only time he cried was when we had Uber deliver chicken nuggets to Seattle Children's. That's worth living in this book. That's worth living in where there's people right there. Like they deliver nuggets.
Chicken nuggies? Oh, hell yeah.
Amazon delivers in an hour there. Yes, sir. That was that.
You're also at Amazon's capital when you're in Seattle. So
I was like, Jared, we could move to Seattle and never have to leave our house. Like, that would be amazing. Like, he's like, what's the point? And I'm like, they deliver nuggies. Like, they deliver. So,
deliver Taco Bell.
They could deliver Taco Bell. Yeah, they take a picture of where they left it. You go get it. It's wonderful. But he tried chicken nuggies, and we'd been through mac and cheese, peanut butter, like all of his favorites, and nothing tasted good. But he's had his mouth open for 14 days and no food. I mean, he got under 100 pounds. He was looking tough. And everything he tasted just tasted – he's like, I can taste. It just tastes bad. And I was like, oh, no, because, his taste buds are dead. And I was like, shit. He wanted sparkling water. They'd give him a mouth swab to like kind of just moisten his mouth every couple hours. And he's like, he wrote, I want bubbles. They're like, well, you can't have a drink. It goes down your throat, goes in your lungs, did this whole thing because his lungs are bleeding. Oh, we skipped a part, huh? Lungs are bleeding. But
you did mention that.
Yeah, look. Yeah, they were bleeding. just one. But the nurse told him if he was able to let them move him to a chair, like sit up, and they'll bring it in. She would get him LaCroix water and he could have some carbonation in his mouth. And I was like,
oh, but that stuff is so gross.
That kid hadn't had a drop of liquid in his mouth in some time. He was like, he wrote deal. And so he's still pretty, like, days before he got off the ventilator, they moved a chair in, an Xbox, and they sat him up, and he slid over into a chair and was playing the Xbox. I was like, this is not happening right. All for a LaCroix water, bud? You won't clean your room for money for me. Like, what's happening?
Well, he also hasn't had anything for how long now? Yeah.
Yeah.
The leverage changed.
We didn't eat in front of him. We didn't drink in front of him. We didn't do any of that. Because I was like, I would kick your guys' ass if you did that to me. So we're not eating in front of this kid. Like,
Hey, Mom, this burger tastes great. Too bad you're intubated.
Yeah, I would swing. I don't care if it killed me. I'd swing. I'll sum it up. The endocarditis broke off in our lower lobe, which you have three lobes on the right side of your lungs. I did not know that. I thought there's only two. There's three. And it killed the tissue where the pieces of the vegetation got stuck. And I was like, okay, all right. And they said, you know, it doesn't take up a lot of real estate down there. So it probably won't, affect him too much as far as long term. And I'm like, all right, well, I was sitting outside and he ran to me to meet you. So he's in PhysCon. It affects him a little, just I think mostly been on a vent tube for that long. His throat's always, always dry. And if he gets winded, he said it feels like he's trying to breathe chalk. It dried out and killed all that tissue in his throat and on his tongue. Like, his taste buds grew back and he likes the weirdest stuff. He is not the same child that we left here with. He likes black licorice now. Absolutely Ew. Not.
I Ew. Love black Ew. Licorice.
It's disgusting.
It's amazing.
He hated it.
You know
he
what?
Hated it.
As a black licorice lover, I love that people hate it. It keeps the price down.
Right?
And the taste literally makes me angry.
I love the taste. It's amazing.
A little. I'm like, ooh, why? Ooh. And he's like, well, my friend was eating it. And Darren, he said, I was like, that's gross. And he said, then I smelled it. And I was like, that kind of smells good. Can I try that? And he came over. He's like, Mom, I like black licorice. I'm like, no, you don't. He's like, yes, I do. Who are you?
And if he's the only one if he's the only one in the house that likes black licorice, then he can buy it safely knowing no one's going to steal it.
What do you think's on his dresser right now? Black licorice and cookies I'm not allowed to touch. And I'm like, ooh, you turd. But as far as his bleeding lungs, they said, you know, there's two things they can do. Put this stuff through his vent tube, like a nebulizer kind of treatment to coagulate, like stop the bleeding. And if that doesn't work, which is the next thing was more evasive, and we didn't want to, but if they had to, that's what they were going to do. They would go up through the artery, you know, through his groin and go into his lungs and just plug those four places, you know, plug them off where they're lodged in the vessels and stop the bleeding that way, which then you're in there stirring things up that are still, I mean, we still got traces of strep in there. We've got, you know, he's still sick, even though he's, you know, don't kill me and he's all fun and games, kid's still pretty sick. And I was like, yeah, if we don't have to go in there and, you know, stir up any dust, let's not do that. So they said 24 hours on this medicine through his vent tube, and because they were suctioning blood out of his lungs every 20 minutes 30 minutes for days. Wow. Like, just a little tube that went down and they'd put it down, and then Darren would lift his finger when he'd be like, that when you've gone far enough, and then they suck it out. And pretty soon he would have probably done that himself if they'd have let him. But then he'd have his little spit sucker, and 24 hours later it was still red. And I was like, oh, like bright, it's still fresh blood. I was like, shit. And this doctor's like, you know, let's do 24 more hours before we do that. And I was like, okay. So halfway through the next 24 hours, blood starts turning dark. And I was like, yes,
the nebulizer's doing what it's supposed to do.
The nebulizer's doing what it's supposed to do, and it's stopping the bleeding, and now we're just getting out the old blood. So I was like, boom, Darren, look at you, just killing it. Yes. And so we didn't have to do the invasive surgery, which was amazing. And like they said that, you know, the tissue that is dead in his lower lobe of his right lung probably won't give him, you know, any grief, considering that was probably the mildest of the crap that was thrown his way, you know. But now I get, well, people can say they have walking pneumonia. How'd you not know you had pneumonia? My kid was using less than 50% of his lungs and didn't even have a shortness of breath. Didn't have a cough, a wheeze, nothing. Nothing. And I'm like, your body's a liar. And I have some things to say to it. I'm like, geez, your back's hurting a little. He's in kidney failure. You're breathing. You're not using any lungs. I'm like, what? Who are you? What is happening? I said, buddy, your willpower. I said, you are the toughest kid I know. And I said, not physically, but who you are in your heart of hearts and your soul of souls that you have no idea because you're 16 and you think I'm nuts, but that there's this thing inside you, your spirit. I said, it's a fighter, buddy. And I can't wait to see what you're going to do in this world because there's a plan for you because you should not be here. You're a freak of human nature, basically. And, you know, and 24 hours after he was off the vent tube, if you do look at his page, the nurse said, we have a basketball court outside and he does have to walk and it's not that far. He thought he was going to walk around the unit. He had to walk like 100 yards and back. Because every day that you're in bed, you lose 7% of your function. And then the next day, 7% more. He didn't move for a couple weeks. So for him to be holding on to his IV pole and walking at all was wild. When they stood him up to take his weight, he could barely stand there for about 10 seconds and he was shaking and holding on to this bar and then he'd sit down. So 24 hours later, though, we walked 200 yards. We walked 100 yards out and he's like, where are we going? And they're like, does he have shoes? I'm like, ma'am, we got nothing. Like, we literally flew in here. And so she's like, okay. So we outside and he's like, and Darren's like, what? And he looks around and she hands him a football and his eyes, and he's still holding on to the IV pole and he staggers out to this basketball or this basketball, stagger at the basketball court. And she's like, you want to shoot a hoop? And I was like, oh my God. And so I'm videotaping and he shoots and he's short and he's like, oh, I didn't make it. She's like, you've only been breathing on your own for 24 hours. Don't be too hard on yourself. Right? Oh my God. And she's holding the pole and I mean, it went up and down, but it just didn't quite have the length. And she's like, well, let's move closer. And he's being hard on himself. I was like, knock it off. Jeez, you little freak of nature. And so then he stands there and my husband threw a football and he caught the football. I took a video and I'm like, this is happening. Like, my husband and my son are playing catch. Right. Like, he was intubated 24 hours ago.
He was knocking on death's door not too long ago.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. 13 days before that, I thought we were going to lose him. And for the next 2 days after we got to the actual ICU here, that second day, I'm not going to say I lost hope because I didn't. I never lost hope. But there's that deep inhale, exhale, and you just go, okay, this is what we're doing. And
let's tell the truth.
This is what's happening.
You know what you can tell Darren? He played ding dong ditch with death.
Yeah. Yeah, I was like, buddy,
he left the flaming sack of dog poo.
And you were like, not today, Satan, not today.
But, he went like this to him.
Yeah, and he has no recollection whatsoever. He remembers leaving the critical care unit here. He doesn't remember the days following when he came to in Seattle. The first time we saw his eyes, you know, and him, he was conscious in days. That's the first thing he remembers. And I was like, hi, buddy. You know, we're in Seattle. And he was like, huh? I'm like, yeah. We've had a rough couple of days. You had a 5-minute nap, but it's been a minute, bud. it's a lot. Yeah. And now he uses it. He's like, mom, I think I should sit in the front. And I'm like, well, I think I'm the mom. And he's like, well, I think I almost died.
He's got a golden ticket.
I was like, that's it. I said, you have some pretty good leverage and that's a good card to play. Are you sure you want to play it for the front seat? Like, I mean, by all means, but pick your battles, buddy. Pick your battles. Like, you're such a
And for those how listening, the story's not done yet.
Oh, it gets better.
Yeah, just getting out, just to the Seattle Children's is not the end of it.
No,
At this point, how long has he been in the hospital?
2 weeks.
2 weeks. Okay.
Yeah. 9 days, and then we got moved to from ICU to inpatient, like to a normal room, which. Him and I both cried the first night we didn't have ICU because ICU, you have nurses, there's a window and they're 24/7. There is somebody right there. When you go to normal room, there's not those people. And I missed the ICU and my
son, no longer in a fishbowl.
Yeah. And my son, I miss the ICU. Mama's like, me too, buddy. Oh, I was scared. All I can see is his blood pressure and his temperature. There's nothing like, and that's, I mean, it's good, but it's very vulnerable after you are literally hooked up. I mean, he doesn't have one spike of anything without them knowing. He's comfortable. There's somebody there to answer. It's your security blanket in ICU. And, you know, he's getting better. And we're good. Then we moved down and we didn't see people for hours. And I was like, what if he needs silent? What if his temperature, like, what if, well, and so, I mean, my husband finally got some sleep and I'm still up with, and we cried a little. I was like, I miss the ICU too, buddy. Like, he's like, can we go back? And I was like, God, I hope not.
I miss it, but I don't miss it that much.
Yeah. So right. He was on penicillin every 4 hours or something like that. And so the second day we were in inpatient after he threw the football, he's like, I want to go to ICU and I want to see my nurses. I'm like, you got it, buddy. You should see this hospital. It is cool shit. Because he didn't get to see anything. You know, he's in the room and we've been to the forest and the ocean and Starbucks. And, you know, so we go up to the ICU.
Plus, honestly, getting him that exercise is a good thing.
Yeah. He couldn't walk very far. So we wheeled him up to the ICU where he was at, and we got out front, and the nurse lady that was out there, we just called her Wonder Woman because there was not a question she did not have the answer to. And she's like, oh my God. And she comes running around and I just start crying because she's crying. And I'm like, stop it. What are you doing? And Darren's like, I want to stand up. I want them to see me standing up. And I was like, okay. So he's standing there and he's holding on to his pole. And two of the nurses walk by us. And then you see them like back up and they look down because they recognized me and Jared. But they haven't seen my son up at all, like a couple of them. So they're like, oh my God. And two nurses came down this way. And then we were looking for the Sherry, the first nurse that he asked not to kill him. She was the first nurse. And they're like, oh, she's back. We'll go get her. And so Sherry comes out. Sherry is bawling and she's hugging my son. And I'm like, and the look on his face, some of those are on his journey home. The look on his face, and she just comes in for a big hug, and I was like, I mean, we're in Seattle. Nobody hugs in Seattle because that's the COVID capital of the world, like, you know. And I was like, just know that I know you guys don't hug, but if you did, I would hug. I'm a hugger, and just know I want to, but I'm not gonna. But I want to hug. And she's crying, and I'm crying, and she's just like, Darren, look at you. And we had all five of his ICU nurses got pictures with him. And it was the most amazing. I mean, these people don't know us and they just were there for 12-hour shifts and they cried with me. The first day we were there, they let us do rounds with them. And they're like, do you want to do rounds this morning? I'm like, yeah. And so, you know, they have the surgeons and it's just like on Grey's Anatomy, but don't say that because they don't like being compared to Grey's Anatomy at all. FYI, don't do
well,
it.
Well, I mean, Grey's Anatomy like,
it's not
was
like Grey's
like,
Anatomy, and no, I'm like, yes, it is. They do rounds.
Yeah, like, well, yeah, but I mean, Grey's Anatomy was like 80%. Let's go have sex in a closet.
Yeah, my son started watching Grey's Anatomy, and you know what he said?
Extra bad in a kid's hospital,
right? <Yeah. laughs>
He's watching Grey's Anatomy. I'm like, what are you doing? He's like, Mom, you didn't tell me there's so much slap and tickle in this, and I'm like, oh God, quit talking to me. I'm like, what is happening in this world? But the first day.
Just so you know, one of our listeners, Alice, is actually going through Darren's journey while listening to this.
Oh, bless her heart. We did rounds the first day, and like the vegetation was still on his heart at that point. So they saw, and so the second day, I just didn't. I was like, you know what? I don't need to know. We're kind of out of that, critical life-threatening zone. I mean, we're teetering on the side of it, but things are looking up. I'm just gonna lay in here with my son.
Yeah. Well,
We're gonna
you're.
play Uno until I hope that Uno just catches fire. I hope there's never another Uno game alive.
You should
Oh,
have.
God, weeks of Uno.
You should have got Phase 9. That's a great game, by the way.
We did. Do you know how long that takes? Do you know how long that takes?
Yeah, I know. My wife and I played all the time. When
Yeah,
she
that's
was
what the nurse.
in labor, that's all we did. We played Phase 9.
Yeah, Darren loved it, and so then we he's got to have the most that they can give you, the highest dose of penicillin is 4 weeks intravenous, and they had a PICC line in his neck and moved it to the artery in his arm, and they're going to teach us how to change out his penicillin bags and clean flush his PICC line. And I was like, yeah, I don't want to do that. Nope, I'm not into it.
I don't want to make a mistake and have my kid right back here again.
Yeah, I mean, we have a line that goes up his arm and stops right on his heart. Let's put me in charge of that, by the way. I couldn't get an eyelash out of my eye earlier. Let's not do that. Like, I'm not in. But I was like, okay, let's do it. And they're like, and then you can go home. And I was like, oh, home is so far. Oh, no. And I told my husband, I was like, man, I don't want to leave Seattle. And Darren's like, yeah, I'm gonna go home. I'm like, yeah, no, not with something, just an open line to your heart in the middle of God's country. You got
120
amazing
miles
care.
away from the nearest hospital, which they had
Yeah.
to send away.
Yeah. Yeah. And I told my husband, I was like, we had phenomenal treatment at the critical care, at the ICU hospital. Everything worked out, lined up, everything was in our favor. What are the chances of that happening twice if we should need it? Because they're like, okay, masks in the room, you glove up, you do this to the PICC line, you take those gloves off, you put on new gloves, and you have to have masks on while you're doing this because the air from your mouth can get into their PICC line, which goes right. The air from my mouth can kill him, and you want to send me to the boonies? Not today. No. And so I was like, oh God. And
And this is where one of my favorite parts of this whole thing comes in pretty soon.
one doctor came in and said, we'd like you to stay in Seattle for these 2 weeks. I was like, oh, thank Jesus, you're the bad guy, not me, because
Yeah.
we weren't going
Can't stay in
anywhere.
the hospital though.
Can't stay in the hospital though. And I was like, okay, yeah, whatever. And the Ronald McDonald House didn't have a room. And we got put on priority placement. And I was like, well, they had a spaghetti feed for my son, and in our little town, that raised $9,700 for my son at a church in a town of less than 900 people with a spaghetti feed in one night while we were in the ICU. That is small town love right there. The chief of police called me because I babysit her children. And she's like, I just thought I'd let you guys you just do what you got to do, and just take the time you need, because your power bill's been paid until you get home by an anonymous donor. And I was like, are you kidding me right now? And I was like, I mean, because I didn't even start to think about home bills, just any of that until Darren was okay, or on his up and up. And then I'm like, oh yeah, there's stuff we got to do, and this whole town, it snowed several feet. It was negative degrees. Guess whose pipes didn't freeze, because small town love. They took care of everything for us back here. And I could not believe, the pastor of this church that I've never been to, a man I do not know, have never met, even in this small of a town. My niece goes to his church, and she's like, this is what's happening. He's like, oh, let's do it. They FaceTimed me the day of. There's women I've never met cooking spaghetti. There are donations everywhere, from kayaks to full bed truck boxes and baked goods. And I'm like, oh my God. And they scan around, and I'm like, what is happening? And my niece is like, this is for you guys. And I was like, what? I was playing football outside. I don't know what you're, because she's like, do you mind if we do this? And I'm like, no, do whatever you need to. And we just never looked back. We never, you know, thought about home. And this town, which if you've ever lived in a real small town, they can be really amazing. But if you,
they can be really nasty too.
If you mess up one time, or, you know, it's real tough to break that barrier to get back in good graces if you're a naughty teen and, you know, destroyed a mailbox. Maybe this summer. I'm just saying, you know, if that happened, and you know, some people are mad at you, it's a rough go of it come school year. I'm just saying. But when, you know, hypothetically, if that child were to get sick, this town would step up. I'm just saying. But
like, you may have destroyed my mailbox, but you know what? I'm going to make you feel real bad for it by, here, I'm helping you.
What the heck? This child. Yeah, they're like, oh, Darren couldn't be involved in anything. And I was like, no, certainly. No. Nope. But so I was like, you know, we've had family send us money. People just deposited money into our bank account. My statement said, anonymous, get well soon, Darren, $200 here. I still don't know. I'm just like, are you kidding me? And I was like, we can get a hotel room until the Ronald McDonald House opens. Like, we'll do whatever. Like, I don't care. And they're like, oh no, there's actually a fund, and it's quite a neat story. There, it's called the Jaden Fred Foundation, and this couple from Missoula, Montana, in the middle of nowhere, also, their daughter went to Seattle Children's, and I mean, unfortunately, she passed away from cancer. And they devoted their Jaden Fred Foundation. She passed away from cancer, and they devoted the rest of their lives to repaying Seattle Children's to what they did for their daughter. And the financial guy,
I'm dropping a link to the foundation into our Discord.
So they have the fund is for food, gas, hotels, you know, because if you're flown into Seattle Children's, you are on a, you're flying in on a prayer as it is. Yeah. I'm lucky I even had my wallet. Like I said, I had no, and it is to help with those kind of things until you can get to Ronald McDonald or whatever you could possibly need is from them. And
is it okay if I take a second to read a little bit about them?
Yeah, absolutely.
Just to give you an idea. So far, so it was established May 25th, 2001. They have given $1.3 million across 1,453 families, which, of course, you're one of them.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's amazing. And they make it really easy to donate. This is awesome. Thank you for sharing this. Like, it is there. So if anyone wants to donate, there you go.
It's wild. And I mean, it's all this little things like that, that you just don't even think about. And I mean, I'm not afraid to say we live in Montana. Like, that's not a secret. So and it's for Montana parents. And the financial guy that we talked to, he's like, my job is to like, make you not worry. I'm going to comb through the state of Montana. My son has no insurance, so that's a good time. And he's like, this is where I come in. And Seattle Children's, I talked to two people for maybe 20 minutes. They had a hotel for us for a week, and the Jaden Fred Foundation paid for that. Well, you know, wheelchair access, because Darren couldn't quite walk yet, and until we could get into the Ronald McDonald House. All of our penicillin bags, which we had to change every 11 hours because you can't get a 24-hour penicillin bag that's stable. So we had to, you know, they break up the bags, and we became pick line flushing machines. We had 80 pounds of supplies, medical supplies delivered to the hotel, you know, gloves, the flushes, the saline, the whatever non-clotting blood stuff, just all of it, all delivered. And we are changing out penicillin IV bags for a week in a hotel. And then we got to the Ronald McDonald House, which was wild. That it looks like a college campus. It's a whole block. There's three enormous like dormitory buildings. It is probably the most impressive thing I've ever seen. We had our own kitchen.
Like personally, I don't eat McDonald's. I can't stand the food. But the Ronald McDonald House is always a charity I've always donated to.
I always put my change in that little thing, you know, since I was in high school and my friend's daughter had to go there. So I was
walking through the airport in Chicago to go see my uncle, and I saw a big donation box for the Ronald McDonald House, and I went, all right, here's my change, and here's a couple bucks. Just walking
by. Yeah, and over Christmas, they brought us slid a thing under our door with a time the next day for us to meet in the lobby, blah, 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 took us upstairs, and I'm going to cry. So they took us upstairs. Every parent had a time. And I mean, there's just hundreds and hundreds of things for you to pick out for your child for Christmas because you're not home. And, you know, we're so far from home. And I was like, what? They're like, yeah, you pick out, you know, some presents for your son. And I was like, are you serious right now? Are you kidding? And, you know, he's 16. He's not the normal, what you see in the ICU. They have babies. They have children, you know, adolescents, just littles. And so Darren was the oldest one in the ICU in Seattle. And he's one of the oldest ones there at the Ronald McDonald House. So they're like, oh, this is kind of younger stuff. I'm like, my son doesn't even care right now. You have no idea. Like, this is wild. They brought around this little, because he couldn't, you know, walk very far, a little motorized scooter so we could walk around the facility. And I was like, I don't think I have tears left. I mean, at least they're all happy tears for the last 3 weeks we were there. But and then we couldn't get a ticket home. Seattle's infamous freezing rainstorms are real. When you see a TikTok and someone sliding down the street on their butt and it just looks like it's wet, that's real. I saw it. It wasn't me, but it was close. I'm like, oh.
I was almost a TikToker.
Bad. Yeah. I was trying really hard just to keep my feet together. And I was like, oh, I'm going to go down as I'm trying to scoot back. I'm like, we're not going outside today. We're not going outside. So, you know, infectious disease, we checked in with every the next 2 weeks, took some vitals. His, you know, inflammation markers were still high. Liver count was still high. His liver took a little extra time getting back to doing what it's supposed to do. And then they're like, oh, well, we have a surprise for you. It's like the 22nd December. And we're going to let him do the last week of his IV meds on oral medication so you can go home. That's neat. I don't have a car. Try to get a plane ticket on Christmas home. Try to find a train. Try to do any of that. Like, I was like, oh, we're stuck here. But there's a big life-size Ronald McDonald outside, and he's kind of cool, so we're going to just make the most of it. And I was like, I don't want to travel on Christmas Day. We'll just ride it out. You know, we'll get home. We had tickets for the 28th to come home. I was like, and we're close to, you know, we'll just, this is what it is, and we'll just make the best of it. And our best friend of many, many, many years called, and my husband's like, oh, yeah, we can go home, but the Northwest is, there's freezing stuff falling from the sky. Like, there passes, Snoqualmie's shut down, you can't get over here. And so my husband's like, well, we can get out on Monday. And my friend's like, all right, well, I'll be there. Yeah, he was there 9 hours later. I was like, Jesus was on TV and said, don't drive. What are you doing? Like, it was bad. And he didn't even tell us and surprised us and came to pick us up so we could be home on Christmas. And I was like, shut up, you're an idiot. God, I've never been so happy to see you. I love you. Well, Amazon delivers in an hour, like I said. So I had some packing to do real quick. Like, we'd been there a month. We acquired some things. I was like, oh, we're going home. Oh my God, we're going home. We're going home. And
I danced in my living room when I read that update.
Was that not wild? Like, he surprised us. He said, well, I got a truck. I'll call you after work. And he was halfway there. I was like, oh my. And only two people knew we were coming home. Only two. So that was, I'll send you a video. My husband's boss, he's worked at the same place for 26 years. All 26 that we've been together, he's been at the same place in this little town. So his boss is like an adopted grandfather to my son. And we surprised him on Christmas Day and walked into their Like, we knocked on the door. I was like, oh, we're crashing Christmas. I don't care. so I have that
After
video.
Everything that's been going on, I'm sure no one cared that you crashed Christmas.
Man, that was the best. We knocked on the door, and my brother opens the door, and my husband walks in, and I just hear, Jared, oh my God! And my boss's wife is hysterical. Jared! I'm crying. The 70-year-old man with a mustache that still scares me to this day. She's like, oh, and I was like, I can't look at any of you. I'm going to cry forever. And we were home Christmas Day. So we had the worst day of our lives on Thanksgiving Day, and we got to come home on Christmas.
One of the best days of your life, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah. When we were in the hospital, you know, the beds are super close, and I could hear Darren's like, psh, of the pump, you know, in his backpack. And I didn't sleep much. And because if there was too long between, I was like, what's going on? Like, I just eyes couldn't. Open. And, yeah. And he never moved when he slept, and he slept hard when we got out of the hospital. I mean, like a couple of days hard where I was like, oh, this is bad. Oh, this is bad.
He's finally comfortable and healing.
He was healing. And so two different times I might have been curled up in the fetal position on the lower side of his bed. I wasn't in his bed, but I was on it because if he moved, I wanted to feel it. And I had my own blanket, and my son woke up one morning. He's like, Mom, did you sleep there? And I was like, no. No.
What?
He's like, you're closer to me right in your own bed right there. And I was like, I just wanted to be close to you. Like, I needed to feel you breathing. I said, shut. And I got up and I went back to my bed that morning. And so twice he's like, Mom, what are you doing? I was like, I was just hanging. Wait, morning. What's going on, buddy? We got home at 1 o'clock in the morning, Christmas morning. And Darren saw, I'm going to go to bed. And I was like, and my nephew and the chief of police broke into my house and decorated for Christmas. And there's lights, and people in the neighborhood had decorated outside of our house for Christmas. And I was like, what is going on with the most enormous snowman? Because we had a lot of snow. And my son's like, I'm going to go to bed. And I was like, oh God, your bedroom's so far away. Like, I haven't been out of arm's reach of you in 30 days. I've watched you breathe for 30 days. And I just looked at him, and he goes, Mom, don't let me find you in my bed in the morning. I was like, I was never in your bed. I was on it, okay? I was on it. I walked away, and I was like, I'll try, buddy. I'll try. I was like, Mom, no promises. Go to bed. Yeah. He's like, Mom, go to bed. And I'm like, oh, okay, I love you. He's like, get away from me. I'm like, oh. There was one day in Seattle, he did kick us out of the hotel. He's like, is there like nothing you guys can do? And I was like, we can love you.
That's something. And I'm just thinking, as a teenager, how I'd be feeling. Be like, you know what? That's awesome. Just get the fuck out.
Man, yeah. You don't know how bad he wanted to say it. And he's like, Mom, I have not been alone in 3 weeks. And I just leaned over and I go, ditto, kid. Ditto.
Yeah, but you can leave.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so I smother the hell out of him. And
he's a happy kid.
Doesn't like to be smothered when they're healthy. And my kid is super, I wasn't sick. Don't look at me like that, like blah, blah, blah. So I'm like, okay. And I went to help him, like, pull his blanket down over his feet. He was trying to kick it. And he goes, Mom, I don't need help anymore. I'm not sick anymore. And I was like, oh, me momming you and me taking care of you, the thing that makes it so that I can breathe in and out every day is what you hate. Well, we have a problem then, buddy. It just reminded him that he was sick, my doting on him. And, you know, he's like, I'm not sick anymore. Like, stop it. And I'm like, but now mommy's sick. Man's like, I need to hug you. So that's been rough.
Now I got a question for you. Do you think he would be willing to come on and talk to about his side of the story sometime?
I think he might. I think he might, because he didn't realize.
I think that would be pretty cool.
If he feels like there's somebody that has gone through, even being on a ventilator, I work with a therapist at my place of where I work at a psychiatric unit, and she called me and she was on a ventilator at one point in time. So I was like, Darren's down in the dumps and his spirit's the only thing that has kept him alive. I cannot let him get sad that he's not home. I can't let him get sad that we're still stuck here. I've got to do something to get him out. You know, even just getting sitting up in bed, we don't have to leave, but you can't just lay here and wish we were home for the next 2 weeks. You can't, like, you're going to get depressed. And they said, you know, watch his mental health. He's survived ICU and it's a lot. Like, he's going to have some PTSD. He woke up a little too early during a procedure. We heard all about it when we got home. He never told us while we were over there. Ripped my heart from my chest. I was like, oh God. He had some nightmares when we got home. So that's all going through my head. Yeah, that's all going through my head while we're in a hotel and he just wants to lay there. And I'm like, I can't let him get sad. His spirit is literally what kept him alive. Like, I got to keep him looking forward to something during the day, even if it's just going downstairs to a vending machine or, you know, at the Ronald McDonald House that was making smoothies every night, whatever.
And it sounds like at one point he was looking forward to you guys leaving him alone.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. He hadn't been alone in 2 weeks. I was like, oh.
It's like, you weren't awake for the whole time I've been here.
Yeah.
He's like, I was sleeping through my first plane ride. I was like, it wasn't that fun, dude. What? But I think he would. So my therapist called and she's like, hey, Darren. And talking to him about, you know, therapized the hell right out of him. He didn't even catch it either. It was awesome. And he sat up and he's like, oh yeah, well, I felt this. And then he got like all into it and told her things he hadn't told us. And I just put her on speakerphone and let her go. And I just kind of like walked away. And he was all about talking to someone that had been through what he had. And he like sat up a little, like, it might be a big deal. I survived some stuff and was more than willing to share and have someone listen to him because he is an expert kind of at in this field.
Yeah. Right now, like, I mean, he was awake while intubated, which is something you're not supposed to do. And he did it for days.
Yeah. Yeah. And talk smack on a whiteboard, though.
That kid has got a champion's heart. There's no other way I can put it. He's got a champion's heart.
He's got wet wash rags on him with fans on him, holding onto this little ice, like orby ball looking thing. That's because it made his hands cold. I mean, because he's deadly sick, and he is asking nurses not to kill him
on his as a joke.
Yeah, as a joke, like, don't kill me. Like, and she's like, well, Darren. I was like, oh. Oh, friend, gosh, dang it, you know, and just
it's like, son, if you weren't so sick, I might have smacked you for that.
Yeah, and on my birthday, he wrote, happy birthday, mom, I love you, and drew balloons on his whiteboard. I took a picture of it, and I was like, oh, and then reminded me that I'm halfway to 90. Oh, daddy of that child. I was like, wouldn't you say you're...
Oh, happy. Shit. I'm over halfway to 92. God damn it.
Yeah, I just made that same way. Yeah. I just turned 46.
You're welcome. Yeah. On my birthday in Seattle. Glad he's alive. And then tells me I'm halfway to 90. I was like, there are witnesses. Little boy, there are witnesses.
Well, it's like, okay, that's a funny little thing. My mom, when I turned 25, she called me and said, so how does it feel to be a quarter of a century old? I responded back going... I don't know. How's it feel having a kid that's a quarter of a century old? Fuck you. Fuck you. Right? You started it.
Okay, well, now that I know that your mom said fuck you, I might have said fuck you to my kid while he was intubated. I was like, stop it right now. I was halfway to 90 until you took 30 years off my life right now. Yeah.
But for the listeners, before we started, we did get to see Darren pop up. And he looks like the happiest kid. Like, he really does. Like, it doesn't look like it's weighing on him at all.
Nope. The only one having a problem since we got home would be mom.
Be me. And he moves like the Flash. Like, he tripped over a dog or something. It looked like he was running away from us.
Right?
He's it's just a dog.
He's like, don't take my picture. And I'm like, I gave you life. You will take this picture. He has two trampolines out here so he can bounce from one to the other. he's like I told you, he's been jumping off countertops, the porch, the diapers. Like, he's given me gray hair long before this. And he was out there doing backflips on the trampoline 2 weeks after we got home. And I was like, okay, buddy, all right, you're tired. Come on, let's go.
He's like, come on. I'm still doing backflips. I don't think I'm that tired.
I was like, what are you doing? He's only had a couple times where he played, the first time he played basketball at school, because he wanted to go back to school immediately. And I was like, you don't have to go back all year. Like, I mean, there's mouth breathers. Okay, you just had your slate mouth breathers. He was on 24 million units of penicillin a day for 4 weeks. That man didn't even have good bacteria. He had nothing. Like, you talk about being vulnerable. Ooh, you ain't got nothing in your body. Like that's as close to born again as you can get.
People, all right, Austin, you're starting to see why I love this woman.
For sure, yeah.
Yeah, and the Niners were in town playing the Seahawks when we were in Seattle. And, oh, Lord have mercy, I'm a sports fan, and that was rough on my ticker. And I was like,
that was a good game.
I know. Everyone else in the hotel does, too.
Oh, because everyone else in the hotel is probably on the opposite side.
100% they were. So I locked myself in and just stayed there. But that morning,
you probably hear a collective "no" as you're going, "Yeah!"
I lost my crap a little bit, but so the chief of police from my little town sent us a big box of stuff that we got in the hospital, and there was an 8-inch Christmas tree with little ornaments on it because we were going to be there for Christmas. A family picture out of my living room off the wall, which she's like, it's not breaking in it.
Uh-oh. Damn it! Right at the best part of this!
Right? Uh-huh. It's the government censoring the breaking in.
Send something from their home.
Anyway.
We lost
you when you're saying it's not breaking in.
Nope. Yeah.
Am I there now? I went outside. Yeah. See, I got to stay inside.
So she said it's not breaking and entering.
Yeah, it's not breaking and entering if it's your family. So she sent my 10-year-old nephew in my house to get a family picture off the wall.
That's a convenient loophole right there.
Right, and candy and some sweatshirts that say Denton Strong on them. And so there was like gold and red bulbs and blue ones. I didn't put the blue ones on until after the game because it looked like a little Niner tree. And like
red and gold, baby.
And everywhere in Seattle, it feels like the elevator just kind of dropped. Like every now and then, I'm like, this city's going to sink someday because this is weird. That morning I got up, I was like, oh, Jared, did you feel that? My husband's like, no, did you like the elevator? I'm like, no, the Niners are in town. And I can feel it.
I know that you wish you could have taken your son to go see that game. I know it.
Oh, man. Yeah, we did get some Seattle Kraken. Because I'm like, I have to be a fan of Seattle. They saved my son's life. And
oh, the Seattle Kraken is my team for the XFL.
We're not going to be Seahawks fans because that's not an option in this house. So.
Well, it's either Seattle Kraken or the Vegas Vipers for me. I like them both.
I got my little Kraken gear. I didn't even know what a Kraken was. Apparently, even 3-year-olds know what a Kraken is. But now I do. Whatever. Don't judge me. I didn't know what a Kraken was. And it's hideous. How am I supposed to dress for that? What am I? Kraken. But we were
just get a mask of my face and you got a Kraken.
A Kraken. I was like, what is it? And my son told me, I'm like, God, that's a horrible mascot. How am I supposed to sport that? Oh God. Well, when my son kicked us out of the hotel room and he's like, go away, go somewhere. Well, I had two pair of leggings and two sweatshirts for weeks. So I was like, Googling. I was like, oh, hey, there's a clothing store. We can walk, you know, it's a close hotel. We're going to walk. And we're walking. Everything's uphill in Seattle. Both ways.
It does feel that way. I've been to Seattle enough times. I'm sorry, Seattle. I don't really like your town. It feels like someone threw a plate of spaghetti at the wall and said, make the streets look like that.
Yeah. Up. Oh, God. We came over this little. We came around this little corner, and I saw the Seattle Kraken symbol, and there's an ice rink. I was like, oh, my God. Oh, sweet Jesus. Where are we? And my husband's a big hunter, and I was like, Jared, do you know how you feel like when you're in the woods and there's elk and you know there are and you can feel it? And he's like, yeah. And I'm like, we're so dangerously close to professional sports and I can feel it. And I just And I was like, I don't care if it's talking, I don't care if it's a squid, I'm going in. And so I got me a sweatshirt and a squid foam finger thing. And
yep, the Kraken. And
it's the Kraken. And we went to the Museum of Pop Culture when my son kicked us out. And I was like, my inner 90s geek was alive and well. I got a Gremlins button.
It's a really cool museum.
I want to go to that museum.
And that's the one thing we did, my husband and I did. That's, they're like, what'd you do in Seattle? And I was like, I watched my kid live. That's what I did.
Like, even the outside the
museum
cool,
and we went back and it was good. And there was some Niner fans walking down the street, which I thought was brave. Two of them in jerseys. And I was like, I waited till they got by, so I was nowhere near them all. No, no! I'm yelling, and then I was like, Jared, go around the corner. We're going to get shanked. Let's go.
Bang, bang, Niners gang! Run.
Yeah. So that was, we did have one day out, and that's because we wouldn't have if he wouldn't have kicked us out, the little turd. But, it was a good day.
You had a good day.
We had a good day, and the whole way home, our eight-hour trip home took 18 because... Well, somebody didn't listen to Jesus on the Weather Channel and drove anyway. So pass closed. We had to go all the way down, come all the way up. It was pretty quiet for 18 hours. I took some little candid pictures of my son looking out the window for hours. And I was like, oh, maybe I'm not the only one self-reflecting on the last 30 days of our lives. And to be going home with our best friend who's been driving us home around, you know, 2 a.m. for the last 20 years, you know, like this is, you know, our friend. And I was like, wow, here he is. And he's taking us home and we're going home and there's my son right there. And it was so surreal. And then to be home, I was like, it almost felt like we'd been gone a year. Like it didn't feel real that we were home. And then my son wouldn't let me sleep on his bed and it was sad. And you know, and that's when I was like, oh shit, that really happened. That, do you know how close we were, Jared, to him? And my husband's like, yeah, where you been the last 30 days? I'm like, I've been lying to my kid. What have you been doing? Because, you know, when he was getting really down in the dumps.
He's been dealing with it as it's happening. You were pushing it off.
Yeah, I can imagine there's a lot of processing once you got home.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I was like, whoa, buddy. And, you know, he was probably about 120 pounds before he got like the flu, which weakened his immune system, which let the strep in. He was 107 when we brought him home and he'd been out of the hospital for 2 weeks and able to eat for 2 weeks. So he was under 100 pounds. It's a different feeling when your kid stands up and you can see his bones, but you're crying because he's walking. And I'm just like, oh, I mean, there's those moments you see it and you're like, okay, you know, and then you're just like, and you just move on. You're just in parent mode. You just go. And he's 136 pounds now. 136 pounds.
So he's 16 pounds heavier than when he got sick.
Oh, yeah. And 107 pounds.
He's gained 30%, you know, plus body weight.
Yeah.
Like put that in perspective.
Yeah, he's gained, so like I said, he was 107 pounds when we got home.
And that was and Christmas, and we are Christmas just in the Day. Beginning part of April, so January, February, March, pounds. About 3.5 months he's gained. That's a lot of weight gain fast.
And he's in PhysCon, and he does, PhysCon twice a day, and he's like, I think I'm getting fat. And I was like, shut up. But he's bulking
up. He looked like a twig! When I saw him, he still looked like a twig.
I know. Yeah. She's seen him before. I was like, he's got a bubble butt right now. And one of his friends was here. And his friend goes, said something about dumpy or I don't know. I go, what are you talking about? To his friend. And his friend goes, oh, come on, Carrie. Tell me you have not noticed the dump truck on your son. And I was like, shut. What did you just say?
You know what you have to do now is pull it out of that old Black Eyed Peas song. What you gonna do with all that junk?
I was like, what is he? I mean, of course he knows, but I'm not gonna tell him. And his friend's like, did you see this? I'm like,
Stop it. Down.
He can't dive underwater anymore. He's too buoyant on the butt.
He just went flying in the door and just scared the life out of my soul. The door's open and the kid just skipped all the stairs. Sorry, the dog's back. Darren's back. There he is. Darren. Can you say hi? I mean, no.
Hey.
Yeah, he's all sweaty and just came running in and just jumped up the steps. So he just dropped from the sky and landed in the living room right there, and I had a heart attack.
Hey, so Darren, would you be willing to come onto this podcast and tell your side of the story?
Not today.
Not today.
Probably.
Cool.
Yeah.
Would really like that. Of course, we need your mom's express permission because you're a minor, blah, blah, blah. But yeah, I'm sure that she won't mind if you want to do it. And we'd love to have you on. We'd love to get your side of the story because, I mean, you went through hell. And you came out, and you came out of it, and I mean, dude, you look great. Okay, you look like you don't look like you got sick.
Yeah, you went through hell and maintained a sense of humor through it, which is pretty epic.
You were fucking with your nurses; that was amazing.
Telling a nurse not to kill you.
I was a little nervous.
Oh, I'm sure you were.
Yeah. And I told him he kicked us out of the hotel room. Like, yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, we look forward to it. We'll talk to your mom and get you scheduled when you're available, and let's do this.
Dude, all right,
cool.
Yeah, it'd be awesome to help, you know, other kids who might be going through, who might be facing what you faced, or have friends who have, you know, and then also to kind of give some insight to other parents who might have a child going through it. Because, like, your mom was sharing that, like, when you were talking to somebody and you shared your experience with them, who'd been through it with you, that stuff she didn't realize, you know. And so to be able to shed that kind of light to other people, I think a lot of people can learn from it and gain some comfort from hearing your story. That's our purpose, is we put this together so that people don't feel alone through the things they go through, and they can have some understanding. And your mom was saying, now you're an expert on the subject.
You are.
Right? You know, so it would be awesome to have a discussion with you. No pressure. If you're not comfortable with it,
yeah,
it's okay.
Don't worry about it otherwise.
You know, we'd love to hear your story, but by no means, you know, don't feel obligated. You know, but it's, you're hearing all about you, you know, from your mom, you know, you said it, you have to be an entertaining person to talk to. You know, I'm sure we'll have a lot of laughs, and like with your mom, there's been a lot of tears today. I'm kind of a rough and tumble kind of guy, and I've probably cried like 5 times talking to your mom through this. So
yeah, we've both been wiping tears away a couple times here.
For sure. For sure. Like, you have a hell of a story, and we're rooting for you. You know, you're already through the story, but we're rooting for you all the way through it, you know, and your mom keeps going, wait, no, we're not done yet. There's more.
And I go, oh, it gets better. And then there's more.
Yeah.
I mean, we've been doing this for 2.5 hours now. We still we have a 37 minutes left hard limit.
Yeah. I know. I was going to ask about an hour in, like, how long do you got? Like, what's going on?
I thought you guys would be done, so I kind of came barging in here.
Yeah, you scared the shit out of your mom, by the way.
Yeah, see, doors open, he just flew in it and landed, and I was like,
nice. My boots don't got a lot of traction, kind of slid.
Well, have a good night, man. Awesome. Seriously. Again, as Oz was saying, there's no pressure. Mm-hmm. We'd love to have you on, but if you change your mind, don't even worry about it. It happens.
All right.
Yeah. All right. Cool. It was good meeting you.
Yes.
Take care. By the way, Carrie, did you notice Oz's shirt, what it says on it?
I have been trying not to say anything all night, and I love it so much.
I get high
do
fives.
Do I go in on that shirt, or do I not? What's happening?
Yeah, I got a. My sweatshirt says, kill your local pedophile. I know we are a peace-loving podcast.
I was going to show Darren.
We are.
But not to everybody. But
kill your local pedophile on a sweatshirt.
But maybe not to everybody. I get high fives from, like, little old grandmas and, like, teenagers.
That's awesome. Now,
grandmas love this hoodie the most.
Now, I will say this. If there's a listener out there who is attracted to minors, but you're getting help and you're making sure not to cross the line, you have our full support.
100%.
100%. We only have an issue with those that cross the line.
You can't help how you feel. It's the same as the gay argument. People are saying, just don't be. You're attracted to what you're attracted to,
right?
But you are held responsible for what you act on.
Exactly. The difference. Yeah. Exactly.
And if you notice it as a problem, then
what a freeze frame.
Right?
You're getting help. Okay.
Yeah. There you are. You're back.
Yep.
If you go to Libby, get me McDonald's.
Sorry, he's like, can I go to Libby? I'm like, yeah, you can. I only have, I want a smoothie. They're going 30 miles away to get me a smoothie.
And I will say, if you are happen to be attracted to minors and you are getting help and you are getting therapy, don't be afraid to reach out to us. We're your allies because you are doing the right thing.
100%. 100%. I feel that there's next to zero support for anybody in that situation because of the subject matter. But if you are doing the right thing and you want additional support, we will do whatever we can to help you.
Absolutely.
Do the right thing.
Just, you cross that line, that's not a line you could ever uncross.
Nope. Mm-mm.
Yeah.
No.
But, you know, again, I think
a lot of people think there's not help available for that, but there is. So, there is.
And you work in a psychiatric ward. You know a little bit more about this, too.
Yeah. A lot of people not coming forward or seeking help is shame and fear of judgment. But people in that field that are there to give you help don't have judgment. And no. I know that's hard to believe when people are like, yeah, whatever. I'm going to walk in there. You're gonna... People choose that profession. They choose where they're at to help the people that they're helping on purpose. Like it's they chose that. And so there's a passion and there's a, you know, there's a wanting to help you. So there is no judgment. And I think that stops, I'd say 90% of people from getting help in any subject, in any field that they may need help in, is just fear of judgment and, shame that this is where I'm at. That's why those people are there. They're empathetic. They want to help you. They know that there's no help. There's always help. There's always someone. And there is always someone that is not going to judge you. So just if that helps take one step forward, just know that those people are in that line of profession because they want to help. Yeah. They chose it. They went to school. They're there to help. They're a wealth of knowledge. They're right there at your fingertips. They're the anonymous and not judgmental and very respectful and want to help you be your best self and be better. So if you have that urge that you want to come, you know, and get help, do it. Seek it out. Find it. Find the help and just know that when you get there, you will be met with open arms and nothing but respect and willingness. And like I said, I know it's hard to believe if you're that down and, you know, I worked at addiction clinic for 4 years. They're shame and everywhere in the world judges you. I get it. You can't go anywhere. Doctor's offices, whatever. They all look at you. But that's why those places are there. That's why we are there. That's why we're like, come to us. We will not judge you. Come on in. We'll talk smack about those people with you. Come on in. Yep. Like, get, you know, and those places are there for help.
And just for clarification with this podcast, we are not professionals in this area. We're just very impassioned people that want to help.
Mm-hmm. And where we may not be professionals, we can definitely help you do the research to find the ones that will help you.
Exactly.
We are here to help.
We are.
Yep.
You can always reach out to us email. You can reach out to us direct message through our Facebook page, whatever.
Through a direct message to our Discord.
Yep. We're here.
And you don't have to be a professional. I mean, to get the help, yes. But just know that there's people that are in the same boat, have been through what you've been through, have been in your shoes. You are not alone anytime, like ever. There's somebody that has been where you're at. And they know what it's like to feel alone, and they know what it's like to not have the resources or be scared and be afraid. And those people are just waiting for the day for someone to need them to help them, because that fulfills both of you. It fills anybody in recovery. It just getting to tell their story or be available to help somebody to pull them up from where they've been. It's so rewarding on both ends. Yes. You get better. They pass on their wealth of knowledge from experience and can relate to you. You're not alone.
No.
Ever.
Definitely not. And if you're new to this podcast or you're just catching this episode or maybe just a few episodes in, I highly encourage you to go to the very first episode, season one, episode one. I wrote a essay when I was really down in the dumps that became the catalyst to this whole thing. And go ahead and check out season two, episode one, where I open up about my attempted suicide. I didn't share it because I wanted this podcast to get popular or anything. I shared it because I want others to know that you're not alone. That if you're feeling suicidal, you know, things do get better. It's not easy, but they do get better. Oz has to leave in 4 minutes.
my computer's down to 2% and I can't plug it in.
I'm glad that he said something because I am electronically challenged and I didn't know how to type back. It was nice to meet you.
No, it was great.
I think this is a good time to wrap up, Carrie. We definitely have you back. I don't
know how long they got because I'll talk forever, so they better lock me down.
But we'll definitely want to have you back. Thank you very much for coming on and sharing the story. I know it's still new, it's still raw, but I thought that it was valuable to do it when you had some time. Oh, we haven't actually concluded the story. Last weekend was the conclusion.
Was rough. It was a rough one. Darren's 136 pounds. He doesn't fit in any of his clothes. I'm trying to be quick. Long story short, we have to go 120 miles away to the nearest store, which just happened to be the ICU he went to. So the last time we drove that drive, I was having a bad day. And I didn't really think it'd be as bad as it was, but we got to the point in the highway where the last time we were driving it, my son was in an ambulance and he passed us and it took my breath away. And it was like it was happening all over again. It was like I was reliving it every inch of that highway, and we had to go past the hospital to get to Cabela's. And somebody, I couldn't breathe, my chest hurt, my throat's closing, I'm trying to lock it down. Darren's singing some god awful stuff in the back seat, some music that I wasn't even paying attention to. And I was like, and all I kept saying is, right here, right now, you got to be right here, right now. Your son's in the back, here he is, he is singing, everything's fine. I was trying to bring myself to the moment so that I wouldn't
looks like.
Yeah,
and I was like, what? And I couldn't breathe, and I was like, and we got to that corner where the ambulance went around the corner, and I was like, and I just, ooh, damn, it was bad. It was so bad. And then we stayed the night in a hotel, and Darren flopped down on a bed, and I walked between the two, and I looked over, and he was on the same side, and I was like, oh, God. And I just backed up, and I was like, I just started cleaning, and or just putting stuff in corners, and I was just like, I gotta, let's put our bag in the closet. Like,
this is also what exposure therapy looks like.
It and I was pretty. Like, what is, oh, God. And, you know, my husband's like, are you okay? And I was like, this is just a lot. This is so, there wasn't a second we were in the hospital or in the hotel in Seattle that I wasn't wiping down something or straightening. If I sat there, things weren't going to be pretty. So I was like, busy it is. Here we go. And it was that, I called the lady that I work with, who is the parent, and I go, what in the hell is this? You know, because I was panicking. My throat felt like it was closing, and oh, the tears were, and I just was like, oh, and I just kept seeing it. And the harder I tried not to see, you know, or that day, it just was there. And I was reliving every moment. I was like, this has got to stop. And she's like, oh, honey, that's what we call a traumatic response. And I was like, well, it's bullshit and I don't like it. She's like, She's like, well, you know, you're doing, you know, the right thing. Try to center yourself, focus, bring yourself back to the here and now. Because I'm like, right here, right now. And I'm looking at my son in the rearview mirror, and he's rapping in the back. The whitest child on the planet's rapping in the back.
Hey, I rap. Just like, come on.
Oh, I do too. It takes a few, but I'm telling you. But I was like, he's right here. He's right here. It's fine. It's fine. And I looked at my husband. I said, you were driving, and I know you're going through some stuff, and you're focused on the road, but I was focused on anything I could focus on. That tree. I remember this telephone pole here, and I remember that here, and I remember this specific stretch, like, because there was so much going on, and I think it was just me trying to find something tangible to hold on to, because it wasn't real what was happening in my head, in my, you know, heart of hearts that day. And it all came back on our way there last Saturday, and that's when I had messaged you, and I was like, I don't think today's a good idea. Like, I think this might be a bad idea.
Yeah. No, we wound up doing an episode of debunking dangerous mental health myths. That's what we wound up doing. It was a good episode. It was one that is like, well, it was like, didn't know that we needed to do until the co-host that was a Bexeth was on, and she's like, hey, so I read this article. I was like, we're doing that.
That's awesome. I wish I was having my own mental health issue. Yeah, I was like, I wish I'd have got that.
You had to take care of you.
And I didn't think it would, you don't think about it. And so then when the doctors told us, you know, Darren will have PTSD, he woke up, you know, 3-4 days later, and he's in Seattle, and he woke up in mid procedure, and, you know, there's no clocks, there's no calendars, there's no reference for time. It's all a blur, and he has no idea what the hallway looks outside. He has no idea what Seattle looks like. He's just, it's all, and I thought, well, I don't think he's the kind of kid to get triggered, blah, blah, blah. And then we drove to the city last week, and I didn't think I was going to be triggered and feel like I was right back in that moment and have PTSD or whatever, however you want to.
And frozen.
Yeah.
I got to read her the thanks that we got in the chat, though.
Yeah.
Come on. Unfreeze.
I'm Darren's in, because they, you know, they put their hand under there every time they walk in. And I'm like, ooh, that smells like sterile plastic tubes. I've got to go over here. I got it. Like, and so you just, you never know what could trigger you. Or I didn't even really know what a trigger was until I'm full-blown panic attack halfway to the city with my M&M wrapping son in the back, and I'm just like, and it was wild. And then we got to the hotel. I'd never even thought about that the hotel would be like that. I was just surviving the drive, and like, we get in the hotel, and I'm like, this is no better. Oh God.
Because you're back in a hotel with your son. Mm-hmm. He's healthy. Yeah. But yeah, no, after everything else, I can only imagine that just made it, that was just one more trigger.
Yeah, he asked me to plug in his charger on the little stand between the two beds, and I was like, ooh, ooh. If there'd have been an Uno game, I might be in a padded room. I don't know.
Yeah, but, PTSD is brutal. Like, the smells, sights, sounds, you never know what your trigger is going to be. The little details you might have not realized.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I went through it last week in full force. I was like, ooh.
Oh, and we lost Oz. He is dead battery.
Well, I'm sorry I kept you so long.
No, that was great. You know, honestly, there's a reason we have a 3-hour limit. Even though we don't ever try to aim for it, it's for the episodes like this. It's for the episodes like this that are just powerful, and an hour and a half is not enough. 2 hours is not enough. There's a lot to tell.
I know my husband's like, you think it'll be like, an hour? And I'm like, can you tell Darren's story in a half an hour? Because I can't. But, you know, I get asked a lot. So what'd you take away from this? What'd you learn? You know, I learned, listen to your body, that it's, there is not one thing that happens to your body that something else in your body didn't cause. When you have a fever, it's not because you're hot, it's because something's going on. Cause and effect. And washing your hands can save your life. Washing your hands, because we're in a different world than when you and I were growing up. Every strain of every common, it's group A strep throat. That tried to kill my child.
That was a nothing burger when we were kids.
Yeah, and so,
I mean, it was bad.
Yeah. But the strains and the viruses and, you know, everything that's going on now is nothing like they've seen. There's a first for everything, and there's a first for everything daily these days, as far as medical goes. And so
there was one thing that you did bring up in our chats about the fact that, you know, what Darren had, there were a number of kids over in Asia that got the same thing, and Darren walked
away. The same time frame.
In the same time frame, and they didn't make it.
So everything I've noticed, and I'm not like a huge conspiracy, but I just don't believe that there's ever too much education. You can never educate yourself enough. It that leads to preparation, that, you know, early detection. Just educate yourselves. You don't have to listen to anyone about COVID or this or that. Just do your own research and just educate yourselves. And that's what I've been doing since we got home. Because I want to know life after septic shock. I want to, you know, I just want to be prepared.
Right.
Hopefully and there's 900 sure side effects and we have none.
And make sure you're taking it from good sources, not just good some sources. Random dude with 3 followers on YouTube's probably not a good source.
Oh, no, you got to dig deep, like library, like deep. Yeah. But between September of last year and January, 40 cases. I can't remember what it was. It's overseas, 40 children under the age of 10 all passed away. They all didn't make it. In Darren got sick in November. That's smack dab in the middle of that. And there's been 2 cases since, one in Denver, and I can't remember what the other one was, and it was a girl, and they were teenagers. One was 15, one was 16, one passed away, and one is still in critical care, and that was right after Christmas, the one in Denver, with group A strep. And he entered the hospital with flu-like symptoms. And he had group A strep. And I was like,
terrifying, similar.
So, I mean, I found 2 cases since Darren, but there was 40 2 months before Darren overseas, and none of the, all under the age of 10. So, you know, it's like I said, not big conspiracy, just educate yourselves, and just be aware and listen to your kids. My back hurts, Mom. I mean, most kids would probably complain a little more if they were in kidney failure, I'd like to think. I've been minded, but.
But also, you know, know your kids, too. If your kid has a mm-hmm. high threshold for pain, that's a warning sign. If your kid has a low threshold for pain, give them some water.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, he'd never been sick, so this was our learning. This was our learning curve.
Yes.
Like, oh, buddy. If you didn't want to go to school, there's better ways.
You could have just said, I don't feel good. I don't want to go to school.
Yeah. And, I mean, it changed. We all left here on Thanksgiving Day and did not come back into our home the same people. I look at life different. It's precious. It's short. And it's out of your control. So hug your kids. Tell everyone you love them so much that it's weird. I just don't take 1 second for granted. It changes the way I look at everything about my life. My son's different and husband's different. I mean, all for the good. It's a lot. And become a lot more grateful and thankful. And I just didn't realize how many little things we take for granted every day that they're going to be there every day.
And I will say that we did get a couple of thanks here. Allison, thank you. This was an awesome episode. Kat said, wonderful podcast. Thank you, Carrie, for sharing your son's story. Please come back for other mentioned things.
Oh, you got. I am full of some stuff. I would glad. I'd love to.
Besides just piss and vinegar.
He is such a little... He looks like his dad, but he opens his mouth, and there I am.
I'm like, oh, I heard it. Yeah.
So, but yeah, thank you for having me, and thank you, everyone, for listening. And I did... One last thing I would say is when there's a kid sick, whether you know that person, you don't know that person, you love that person, or you hate that person, if you have a child... You all of a sudden just become fellow parents, and the empathy level, the sympathy level, the support, the compassion. There's people, strangers. Darren got a box of applesauce from Michigan through Amazon because all he wanted on his little bucket list board was applesauce, and it was on his story. And a stranger sent us applesauce in the ICU. If you're a parent and there's anyone on earth that has a sick kid, whether you detest that parent or not, you're a fellow parent, and they're a fellow parent, and the support And the love is amazing because there is nothing you go through in life that prepares you for shit like parenthood.
And it has a habit of burying hatchets.
Yeah. Yeah. It does.
It can either you can either make things a lot worse between you guys, or you can use it to bury the hatchet. And I'm a big I'm a pacifist. I like peace. I like, you know, people cooperating. So
crisis.
Crisis really does bring out the best. The best or the worst of people.
It does.
It really does. And like, I saw a whole room on FaceTime. Darren was too sick to join the benefit spaghetti feed because we were going to surprise everyone with a little video, and he was really, really not feeling good that day, and very self-conscious about his appearance because he was under 100 pounds that time. And there were people there that I didn't think even, you know, liked us or knew. And there's people I didn't know. There was people from the critical care town that sat next to my parents were like, oh, we don't know him. We just saw the flyer. And I'm like, oh my God. And so there's just a room full of fellow parents that there's a kid sick. And as a mama or as a dad, you know, that parent is, that sucks. They're going through it. And you go through it with them, whether you know them or not.
Yeah.
And
I mean, and your whole story, I was there that whole time. Like I said, I was glued to Facebook updates.
Well, I started it because my phone was blowing up, and the day that we were in Kalispell, you know, the day I was like, okay, here it is. This is what's happening. I was like, I'm going to make a page. And if people not just my parents, but our whole town, and I know they're on the edge of their seat, the teachers, the school wasn't the same. We got home and the principal hugged me up, and teachers that I haven't met, they sent pictures from class for Darren throughout this. It just wasn't the same here. And we went to a basketball game when we got home, and there's a police officer who's crying, hugging my son. It was wild. It was amazing. I said, fellow parents, you would never wish for somebody's kid to be sick or anyone to feel the pain of that, as a parent. And that's where it just crisis brings you together.
I just can't think of a more monstrous thing than to wish something ill on a child of a parent that you don't like. It's not the child's fault. Yeah. It's that whole, don't punish the son for the sins of the father.
Yeah. And anyone that's ever had a sick child or still has a sick child, I went on so Darren's journey home, that page became update about Darren and update and update. And as he got better, it became more my journal, my diary every day of what I was going through and what I was thinking as he's laying there sleeping, because there's no change in his condition. But man, parents of kids with diabetes, with cancer, with God bless you. You're tougher than woodpecker lips, all of you. I can't.
Oh my God, I haven't heard that since I was a kid. All right, but we do have to go. We are out of time. Again, Carrie, thank you very much. It was seeing you again. It was great talking to you again. Like, my little kid's so happy about this.
Next time.
My little kid is just so happy over this, you know?
I know, right? I'm like, I want to throw sand at you so bad right now.
I want to throw grub at you right now.
Thank you. Thank you guys so much.
Absolutely. All right. So we'll catch you guys next week. Until then, I'm E.
I'm Oz.
And we'll catch you then.
Bye, Carrie.
Bye.